Hey, everyone. We're going to get started in a few minutes, but I just wanted to ask that we not use flash photography. You can take photos, but just to respect those around you. The restrooms are in the lobby as you come in, so if you need that, feel free to just get up and stretch and everything. We'll get started in just a few minutes, and thank you so much for coming. We're so excited. Excellent. Welcome. Welcome, friends, old and new. Just kidding. Welcome, friends, old and new, families, colleagues. We really thank you for being here today. It's such a special time, and we're really happy to have you here in the SVA Theater in New York City in person. And a big hello to those joining us on our live stream online. And most of all, congratulations to our amazing class of 2023. Yeah, we love cheers. My name is Mia Osaki. I use she, her pronouns. I'm the chair of Design for Social Innovation. It's an MFA program at the School of Visual Arts here in New York City. DSI is a place for people to explore and improve the practice of design. We work collaboratively in communities to support the health, safety, and well-being of our people, our systems, our planet, and all living creatures and beings. As our practice in DSI, I wanted to start with a land acknowledgement. This is an opportunity for us to remember that we're standing on here in New York City and benefiting from lands that were previously inhabited by the Lenape people and other native tribes. They were here first, and they also experienced erasure and forced displacement as a result of colonialism. And connected to this, in this month, it is Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month. And as a Japanese American whose family was imprisoned during World War II with thousands of other US citizens of Japanese descent, I need to just express the urgency for us to listen and learn from the past, to not perpetuate oppression and violence, and to just coexist together more with care. So today is about co-creating for change. And the students chose this topic, so I'm going to tell you a little bit about what it is and give you a little bit of background on this extraordinary group. So how many of you have experienced some change in the last couple of years? Yeah. It's, you know, change comes from hours and hours of commitment. These students, as designers, do rounds and rounds of iteration and ideas. They do hours of conversations. They have to forge new relationships. They make things. They do things. They monitor and they evaluate. Is it working? Is it not? And it's a continuous cycle of failures, of cycles, of restarts and realizations to get to transformation. And they know this oh so well by now. Co-creation, which we call designing together, happens every step of the way. And I've been just reflecting on when these students started 2 years ago. A usual DSI cohort starts at the same time. They all come in fall. And what happened because of COVID-19, we had two groups. So 10 of the students came in September, and then 6 months later, 5 of them joined after taking a gap year as the pandemic slowed. So this group themselves had to piece together their syncopated perspectives, sometimes really disjointed pacing, and their divergent mindsets, embodying the messiness and the spirit of collaboration. So they've come a long way in their journey. This is also our first cohort fully in person after lockdown. So they were finally able to do their work again outside of New York City. So they worked in communities. Some of them bravely went to China and India, for example. Yet unpredictable challenges persisted of what it means to make change in a time of precarity. With hybrid encounters, unknowns at every turn, new tools, ethical considerations that we never had to think of before, and the ever difficult decision to Zoom or not to Zoom. So what you'll see today is 2 years of a thesis that was co-created in partnership with communities, organizations, those with the lived experience, and because they've lived it, they have the expertise. They work in real world settings. Today, they're gonna share their mosaic of innovations, big and small, with you. How they found ways to connect and find pathways different, but together as social designers. They looked at the invisible and the hidden, things too small or too overwhelmingly big. Topics we don't wanna look at or are too uncomfortable, physically and emotional, to embrace and conceive. What's happening in the environment, education, mental health, water access and human rights, neurodivergence, artificial intelligence, intergenerational communities and trauma, waste, and even from a bird's eye view, our own families, or who's sitting next to us, this all benefits from collective compassion and creativity. Most importantly, I want you to remember that their work shows the possibility for a future that we might want to live in. Co-designed with shared values, with equity and mutual benefit. This is what they've accomplished. Education as the practice of freedom enables us to confront feelings of loss and restore our sense of connection. It teaches us how to create community. Bell Hooks, in her book, Teaching Community, A Pedagogy of Hope, reminds us. For that, our thesis advisors and our study guides, Mari Nakano, Sahar Gahari, Kara Meyer, Lona Vincent, we're grateful for your love and the commitment that you've given them to learn with freedom. We look forward to hearing from our thesis advisors and the graduates today. But before we do, I'm honored to introduce our keynote speaker, Alain Sylvain, who knows well about these topics of purpose and commitment and stewardship. He also knows a thing or two about design. He's the founder and CEO of Sylvain, which has offices from LA to the Netherlands. And we're so lucky to share the stage with him today. I'm so excited to know you and meet you and have you in our community. So please give a warm welcome to Alain.
Hey, hello everybody. Hi, how are you? I'm excited to be here and learn more about DSI. And I'm gonna move so I'm closer to all of you. I'm gonna move around. But I wanted to let you know a little bit about what I do and why I'm here and what I like the feelings I have for where, you know, you might end up and what you might do. You know, you're on this path now where you're thinking about, you know, working on behalf of clients to solve their own needs. That's something, whether you're in-house or at an agency or a studio, that's stuff you're thinking about. And for me, I really think a lot about how do we evolve from being, as consultants, as outsiders, how do we evolve from being just bystanders to our clients' whims and wishes to more of stewards? You know, because you carry with you a great burden and a great perspective on change that needs to happen. That's what you're teaching here. So how does that unfold in the private sector? And if you're serious about this work, I think you need to engage the private sector. So as Mia mentioned, I run Sylvain. You can Google us if you want, check us out. We do a lot of strategy and design work. We hire people, not so much these days, but but you know, it comes and goes. We're about 90 people at this point. And we do brand strategy and innovation. We help develop insights, and we help organizations organize themselves. So you can check us out. Now, I do want to mention, we work with a lot of big, bad companies. You know, our biggest client is Nike. We work with Apple. We work with Google. We work with Meta, which some people at my company are like, I don't want to work on Meta. We work with Amazon sometimes. But we also work with nonprofits. We work with ACLU. We do some pro bono work. We're a certified B Corporation. We've been a certified B Corporation for 5 years. When we got the certification, we were the only agency like ours in the world to actually have that certification. And I'll explain why and how that comes to life. This is us. We're a bunch of misfits and weird, and you can check us out anytime. But I actually want to pause and tell you a story, okay? This is Tri-Cities High School in Atlanta, Georgia. It was created at a time in the 90s where they brought together four different school districts that sort of had, that were kind of going on their own path. And as a result, you had this kind of eclectic mix of kids coming together, and these two cats came together, and they were really outsiders. They were bizarre. They were dressed funny, and they danced, and they found each other in the cafeteria, and then they started rapping and rhyming together and telling stories, and people were paying attention, you know, these two guys. And eventually they, as you know, true to the outsider spirit that they had, they were like, let's create a group, and they called it Outcast. As many of you might know, it's Andre Benjamin and Big Boy. And again, these were outside. These were not like at a time where Wu-Tang and Biggie were kind of glorifying gang rap and sort of like a side of Black American life. They were really more thinking about community and thinking about education, what some call backpack rappers. And you know, they ended up hitting it big. Like they created this album that was kind of crazy. I mean, we all know that. I hope you know the song. It's the Hey Ya song. Like it was just everywhere. It was like wall to wall. It was a huge, and so huge that they kind of cleaned up at the Grammys shortly after in 2004. And then you know, not surprisingly, the Super Bowl people asked them to perform. I mean, they were super pop stars. They were like running stuff, right? Stick with me, okay? Stick with me. I'm telling you a long story. And they turned it down. They were like, well, we don't do the Super Bowl. They had their reasons. And instead, the NFL asked Janet Jackson to perform at the Super Bowl. And you might remember this. This was like very famous because she flashed her breast at the halftime show, and everyone lost their mind, and conservative America lost their mind. And then what happens shortly the day after, this is a long story, okay, so stick with me. So the day after, these four guys that worked at, or three guys rather, that worked at PayPal, they came together and they were like, did you hear about this thing, this Nipplegate thing? Like, where do we get this video? And they were like, man, if there was only a place, they felt like they saw a gap in the market, so to speak, and they created this thing, and which shortly after YouTube was created just to find that video. And they ended up, you know, commercializing it. And obviously we know what YouTube has become. It's launched careers. You know, there would be no Justin Bieber without YouTube. You're welcome. But, you know, TED and all these like stars and phenomenal education is on YouTube. And this whole idea of streaming was really born out of that invention. And of course, that sparked a whole bunch of other innovations from TikTok to Twitch and so on. And really that all started with Tri-Cities High School in Atlanta, is my argument. So you're probably familiar with the butterfly effect. The things that change the world are the tiny things. A butterfly flaps its wings in the Amazonian jungle, and subsequently, a storm ravages half of Europe. I truly believe in this, and as you know, those of us that are in kind of the private sector, those of us that are working, we touch on decisions all the time, and we have to be conscious of that butterfly effect. Every single pixel, every single click, every single move has an impact. Of course we can't think of everything, but are we aware of our place in that chain of butterfly events? And aware that there is in fact a reverberation. There is always a reverberation, small or big, in the choices that we make. Whether you work in my business or not, there's obviously a natural reverberation. And I often think about the alternate universes. Okay, if I said one thing to one client, that would have led to a whole stream of events. If I said another thing to another client, it would listen to a whole other stream of events. And it's like another dimension. It's, you know, and we are obsessed with alternate realities in pop culture these days. We're constantly thinking of what could have been. And I think about that all the time with every single client I have and every single choice, because every decision impacts so many things. Every business decision impacts the leaders, the stakeholders, the employees, the shareholders, and of course, certainly the environment. Are we conscious of that? And I would argue that a lot of people that do on the consulting side aren't really thinking about this. They're not thinking about it. They're thinking about client needs. They're thinking about their own needs. And so we really have to embrace the fact that business decisions have tremendous power and impact to impact us in large, obvious ways, but also in subtle ways. Listen to this quote from the ex-CEO of Abercrombie & Fitch. "Candidly, we go after the cool kids. We go after the attractive, all-American kid with a great attitude and a lot of friends. A lot of people don't belong in our clothes, and they can't belong." This was in 2006. The aspiration was this kind of exclusive thing. And at the time, you know, if you were a shareholder in Abercrombie & Fitch, this was like interesting in the way that maybe, you know, if you care about business, Equinox is interesting. You know, it was like the very exclusive thing. And they made a killing. They made a killing for many years. And this is a tweet that was, published over a decade after that really speaks to my point. "If you're in your mid-20s, I bet a lot of your current self-esteem has to do with what your relationship with 2006's skinny, low-waisted Abercrombie jeans fashion was. Because I was 12 at the time, and it was the pinpointed perfect window to absolutely ruin me for life." Like, that. Imagine at Abercrombie & Fitch in 2006, there was a meeting, and people were like, "Yo, I have an idea. Let's make this super exclusive and hard, and let's exploit young girls' own self-esteem to sell this." And someone was like, "Yes, let's do that." And they invested in that, and it grew, and they made a lot of money. But look at the impact that some can articulate, some can publish on the internet, but others, it still sits within inside them. And this is just one demographic and one brand in one moment in time. Can you think about all the other things that can be said on behalf of the clients that we work for? And you know, they're very noble intentions sometimes. This is the Strava app that was a tool to help cyclists kind of mobilize and localize themselves in communities. But, you know, the U.S. military has kind of had to put the stamp on it because the Strava app would show where military bases were located, because you could literally go to the Strava app, which was meant to add value to people's lives, and then realize that you're actually, there's like a military risk, there's like a national security risk, because you could see where people that work at bases were kind of hanging out. So you can have these like noble intentions, but these business decisions can have sort of negative impacts. You know, Zillow, famously before the epidemic, they decided to buy a bunch of homes, you know, because they have this algorithm, they can tell you the value of the home. So they were able to identify homes using their algorithm and then resell them. And again, it was like a board meeting, people were like, genius, not realizing that in fact, that had an incredible impact on communities of color, because people were kind of boxed out of communities, people were unable to buy these homes. And they were suddenly, you know, Zillow was like a land shark or something like that. And that certainly wasn't part of the business plan. That certainly wasn't the intention. So sometimes in an effort to be innovative, in an effort to be creative, in an effort to be first and to blow people's mind, we're making decisions that have lingering chain-like impact to everything we do. And there's a lot at risk. I don't need to tell you. You're coming out into this world with such an awareness and it's such a moment in time. It's just incredible how much is happening every single day. And every one of our clients, every one of them touches many of these dynamics. And so we have to be mindful of that. Where do we, as studios, agencies, consultancies, designers, where do we sit in the midst of all this reverberation and all this chain of impact of all these things happens? Like, what is your role gonna be in that? That's something I ask myself with my own companies. Like, what are we, you know, I'm not saying that we nail it, that we've got it figured out, but at the very least, we should be very mindful of that chain of events. Because all these companies, think about all these companies, all the clients that they have, all that they're potentially able to do. You know, the agencies and consultancies worldwide generate over $1 trillion. That's kind of insane. Okay, so tons of money goes to professional services for people to make decisions that have the impact that sometimes we're not fully aware of what's possible. Think about RGA, I don't know if you know RGA, just down the street, agency, huge agency owned by Interpublic, tons of offices, thousands of employees, making tons of money. McKinsey, you know, the ultimate management consulting company, number one, literally, thousands and thousands of people worldwide, advise the most influential people in the world. Frog, industrial design and innovation. Think about all the people that they touch. These are all companies that have great influence. So how do we harness that influence? How do we harness that influence is a kind of a key question. I believe there are three ways to do it. And I'm just going to quickly go through these three as we embark on this work, right? The first, do nothing. The second is reorient towards your duty. And the third is reorient toward your values. So let me explain what I mean. The first is do nothing. And that's really being a bystander. I have kids, and they learn a lot about being an upstander. You know, if you see someone being bullied or something, like you actually have the courage to say something and do something about it. And I think a lot of consultancies and agencies are sometimes bystanders. And that's a natural instinct that's actually neurological. It's tied to evolution. It's fight or flight. Sometimes you're at a client, and a client would say, let's do cigarettes. And you might have, it might be against your values, but you don't want to ruffle feathers, and you feel a threat. So you're like, cool, we'll help you. Or we won't do anything, actually, to ruffle that whole effort. And there's an example of a, there are many examples of this, but here's one of an agency in London called Richmond and Towers that worked with the almond milk industry, you know, trade industry, to really get people to embrace almond milk. And they came out the gate very early on and made the argument that it was good for the earth at a time when people really were looking for an alternative to dairy. And they did a huge campaign, generated a bunch of profit for that company. It was a company called Alpro. It wasn't the trade. And the Advertising Standards Authority in the UK ended up censuring that whole campaign and the company for making that claim, because in fact, almond milk is actually not the best possible thing for the environment relative to the way they would talk about it. In fact, to produce almond milk, you're using, you know, not as much water as dairy, but far more than other milk or dairy substitutes. So for Alpro to say we're good for the environment was a false claim that came from an agency. An agency made a false claim. The company had to pay for the price. And you've actually miseducated people. Miseducated that things, something that you can't really undo. And so I think a lot about bystanders. It's not, that's bad. But I think what's worse is maybe reorienting towards your duty, and just your duty. Just thinking about what you're asked to do, and not actually, it's not a question about fight or flight. It's just like, let me further my client's objective regardless of how I personally feel about it. And that's something we're confronted with often. And I think that's about being complicit. That's about being an accomplice. And no example speaks to this more to me than the opioid crisis in Purdue. Okay, so Purdue's strategy for selling opioids was allegedly summed up with the tagline, "We sell hope in a bottle." This notion of "we sell hope in a bottle," which is not too different than, like, this is great for the environment. This was an invention of an outsider, not people that worked at Purdue. It was an invention of advertising agencies and consultancies. And I don't need to tell you what the impact of this has been. This number is actually far greater. This deck was written a long time ago. This number is actually far greater. Hundreds of thousands of people have died in the US from overdoses involving opioids for the last 20 years. McKinsey was central to that whole, they architected the entire thing. They sat close to the Sackler family. They pushed this agenda entirely through, and they had to pay a fine for $600 million for their role in the opioid crisis. Now, I want to stop for a second. A consultancy had to pay a fine for $600 million for their role in a client's business, and the clients settled for billions of dollars. McKinsey, who doesn't make opioids, just consults on opioids, had to pay $600 million. $600 million. So my company, I think we make a lot of money. We make $20 million. That to me is like, holy shit, that's a lot of money. Like, McKinsey had to pay $600 million for a mistake they made for one client. Okay, just think about the amount of damage that outsider must have, like, done to the world that they had to pay that fine. These are companies that you can work for. These are companies that want to hire you. These are companies that are pay very well. We have to think about these sorts of consequences in everything we do. And it's far from over. It's far from over, okay? It's not only McKinsey. There are tons of agencies still working on behalf of this agenda. There are tons of PR agencies and others working on this. So that, to me, is about being an accomplice and really orienting towards your duty. What's the alternative, okay? To me, what I think I'm trying to do, and a lot of people I know are trying to do, is kind of create a new space where we're reoriented towards our values. You know, can you work for some of these companies and actually still stay true to your values? This is what we're trying. We kind of feel like we're astronauts. Like we're trying to figure out if this is possible. Sometimes I think we've done it. Sometimes I think we've failed. What does that mean? That means being a steward, not being a bystander, not being an accomplice, being a steward. Take the role of guiding the clients seriously and really share that inner perspective, that instinct you have for what is right, what your values are. And I forgive me, I usually don't talk, you know, about my own company so much, but I want to take a second and talk about how we do it at Sylvain. Because as you're thinking about where and how to serve as an outsider for some of these companies, you know, this is what we're trying to do, and this is how we're trying to be a model for it. And you know, we did an impact report, which, by the way, a lot of studios and agencies and consultancies don't do. We did an impact report. We do one every year. Our first one, we said that as advisors to the world's most powerful companies, we are very much stewards of the public trust. As such, it's our moral obligation to work with our clients to align the actions of decision makers in corporate America with the pursuit of social justice and environmental health. We feel it's a responsibility. We don't always get it right, but if we can help Amazon make a decision, turn their ship by like 0.5 degrees in a direction that we believe in, then I think that's positive work, especially because there are other agencies willing to do that work that are very easily happy to be a bystander or an accomplice. And so I'll give you a quick example of time we did this. We worked with the WNBA. Any basketball fans in the room? Go Knicks. I was at the game last night. It was awesome. Anyone watch the WNBA? Not many people do. Yeah, okay, good. Good. I'm happy to hear that. So we actually worked on the entire reinvention of the WNBA a couple years ago, and we used this idea of being a steward. We very much thought about it. Like, how do we stay true to our values? And we ended up rethinking the business. We did an innovation strategy, brand strategy. We also did the identity, which you see there, that graphic there. That's something we designed. And I want to tell you the question that came to us first was, like, how might we enable a women's professional sports league to better connect with fans and deliver long-term profitability? And for us, we drew so much inspiration from the players, okay? The players of the WNBA, 85% are Black. They're largely queer or gay. They're incredibly politically progressive. They were taking a knee long before Colin Kaepernick was taking a knee. 100% of them have some form of college education, which is unlike what I call the MNBA, the Men's National Basketball Association. These women are incredible, okay? Not to mention elite athletes. I played basketball with them, and I got dunked on, and that was a very humbling thing for me. These women are incredible. And so we drew inspiration from that core audience, and we looked for echoes of those women, those kind of progressive-minded people, and we talked to people around the country that we thought really reflected what the WNBA stood for. This was at the height of Serena Williams, before the U.S. Women's Olympic soccer team kind of did their thing. We really felt like if you were going to create a women's professional sports league from scratch in 2018, which is when we did this work, it would look very different than what the WNBA was. And so we did many things, as I said, but one of the things that really reflects what I'm talking about is the redesign of the identity. And I don't know if you could see in the GIF, the first image, the one that's got the background, the Black background. That's the old logo. And the old logo, the player, she's kind of short and stocky. It looks like she's wearing a skirt. Her hair is straight. And it's like, these are not the players. These are not the players. And so we got to know the players. We talked to them about who they are. And we knew that we needed to make her regal-esque. Her arms are big. She's ripped. It looks like she could be dunking, which is controversial in the world of basketball. Women aren't allowed to dunk. You know, her cheek is up. Her hand is up. She looks hopeful. You know, you see her hair is in a bun. You know, I interviewed one of the players, and Black women's hair, by the way, you know, I don't need to tell you, is a very serious topic. I talked to the players how they present themselves on the court, and I was like, I see you wear a bun. Why do you wear a bun? And Nneka, who's this amazing player, playoff winner, she's like, and forgive my language, she's like, I put my hair in a bun because I'm out there to fucking play. And that spirit of like intense competition and intensity, we knew we had to put into the identity itself. And so we had a ruthless commitment to staying true to this kind of inclusive mindset. And we brought it to life through campaign work. we created an actual commercial. We don't usually do commercials. We created a commercial. And we made sure everyone who worked on this commercial, every creative, every director that was there, the director of photography, the cinematographer, the caterer, everybody that touched this campaign was either a woman of color, or a gay, queer woman of color. It was a ruthless commitment. And that sort of spirit is what I'm talking about. Now, here's the thing. When you're super committed to your values, am I almost done? I'm almost done. I'm almost done. Okay. I'm sorry. I'm almost done. When you're super committed to your values, there's real business opportunity there. And it can actually, the truth, when it comes through on the other side, people relate to it. And that's what happened what's beginning to happen with the WNBA. People see the WNBA as truly distinct. And that icon, you see that orange sweatshirt there with the logo, that's actually the highest selling merch item that the entire NBA sells today. It's a cool fashion thing. So how can we direct clients when we aren't addressing our own failures is a question I ask a lot. You know, here we are talking about all these big companies. What about ourselves? And so when you're out in the world, I think you should think about the places you're working and how are they addressing their own failures? Because a B certification alone doesn't do it. And there are many problems with that in itself. So, you know, what we've done is try to challenge what measurement actually means. Because pure measurement on its own and reporting doesn't always further progress. You have to kind of go a step further. And so what we did is, as I said, we did an impact assessment, and you're welcome to check it out, where we really ask these hard questions. We developed our own progress vision, which you can go online and read. What do we mean when we talk about social innovation or progress? We talk about how we evaluate our client opportunities, you know, how we measure what we should actually work on. Is it good for the craft? Is it good for relationships? We talk about the traits and components that we really try to espouse within the company. And so I invite you to check it out if you're curious and you know what a steward consultancy might look like. When you become a steward, you recognize that you have just as much control as an owner, but a responsibility that's greater than yourself. I think certainly speaking to people that work in education, you're thinking about that. Educators kind of think this way. So anyway, thank you for the time. My name's Alain. I'd love to, wish you well in this next chapter.
Thanks, Alain. Thanks, Alain, for that really powerful keynote. I was just noting here that was super eye-opening, and I think we really appreciate the lessons and the connections that you drew for us. So really grateful for your presence today. Also, I am a former basketball player, played from when I was super little. So that was an awesome example, and I'm definitely gonna be buying one of those hoodies, or at least asking my partner to buy me one, maybe for my birthday. But anyway, thank you so much. So good day, everyone. I know some folks are coming in from different time zones, day, night, all of that, and some people are staying up super late to watch these students present on stage tonight. So thank you so much for being here. My name is Marina Cano. I am an adjunct faculty and thesis advisor, and I'm joined here on stage with a fellow advisors, Kara Meyer, Lona Vincent, and Sahar Gahari to welcome the class of 2023. So hello, butterflies. We are here, okay? So as I was reflecting on this past year, I kept having this feeling like I had to catch my breath. And when I sat with that feeling for a while, one, I realized I'm out of shape, but I also came to realize that out of breathness was that feeling of the long personal journeys you all have had. We have worked really, really hard to be here. At points in your journeys, you were confronted by and had to decide how to navigate the unexpected, and you were asked to step outside your comfort zones. Get some tissue. I see some tears happen. Oh my! And I hope I don't cry. I always cry every year. the thing was, you weren't just being asked to do a thesis project. You were asked to find and share your voice, the voice that you're going to be sharing on stage in just a few moments. And so let's just, I just want to pause and just take a big collective breath, all of us, just to breathe in and take a slow, gentle breath out. And as you do this, take all those jitters, take all those like OMG, WTF moments, right? Any of that soreness, that physical, you know, or emotional, and let's just like shake that all out, okay? I know I'm like being like a yoga instructor right now, but let's just do that because I want you to bring your best energy forward to this stage tonight, today. So, you know, I just want to say we are here, okay? We are here. We made it here. And we are here together ready to share our journeys with you all, our harvests, and our visions forward. So, because today is a gathering, right? It's a sharing time. It's a time to celebrate and recognize the work of these 15 incredible human beings. And we have some messages to share with you all, so I'm going to pass it off to Kara to start off.
Okay, congratulations. The first project we're going to hear about today is the amazing work of Pallavi. Bravo. Pallavi, you navigated some major unexpected challenges in the field and have delivered what I consider a poetic tribute to the water sources in Delhi. Connecting communities to their water sources through tradition is such a beautiful way to raise awareness and drive action in a way that is unforced. Shashank, your playful approach to the issues driving inequities across systems is a refreshing way for all to engage and reflect. I love how you creatively leveraged AI to develop your design and have been amazed by your rapid prototyping, testing, and refinement, particularly in these past few weeks. So congratulations. And Brittany, I've learned so much about the gaps in services to young people who might have a hearing loss from you. I love the creativity in your project and the way in which you have leveraged your own lived experience to design programs that schools, companies, and other groups might be able to leverage as they prioritize hearing health for their people. So congratulations to you three, and Lona.
Thank you. I am gonna start with Riddhi. We wanna just thank you for championing a very important community of women and their self-care. You've really been a very strong advocate and have developed a deep, strong voice as your champion. And I've learned so much from you. I continue to learn from you every day, and I really just want to congratulate you from this experience. And Sophia, I thought about two words to define you. It's really heart and empathy. You bring both of those things to your project and thinking about the relationship of mental health and parenting, and it's just been a pleasure watching you through the semester. We're grateful for the work that you're doing and the way that you're thinking about changing the care experience, and congratulations. And Wuyo. We want to thank you for really believing in the relationship between humans and nature. You fought for it, and it shows. And it's been a pleasure watching you experiment with prototypes and build your confidence throughout the semester. And the way that you've grown has been truly impressive to watch and experience. And your creativity shines through, and we want you to know that. So we look forward to your presentation today.
Thank you. Ikun, thank you for your bravery, your dedication, and your willingness to try new things and pivot as you learn. In this world where people feel isolated and lonely, you've been able to create a safe space for people to speak their truth and be who they are in community. Thank you. Daphne and Nancy, thank you for the peek into the Miao community that we otherwise would have never known about. It is so important that interventions like this exist to help preserve the cultural heritage of communities that may be invisibilized by modernization. And Diva, I love that you're connecting us to the non-human world. It really is our future. Your perseverance in all of this has been really admirable. Thank you. There's so much room for you to grow in this space, so keep going. To the three of you, thank you for your hard work and for letting me be a part of your journey. I can't wait to see what you guys all do in the future. Thank you.
All right. Just a couple more amazing people to say hi to. Mohui, I will forever be in awe of the sheer amount of work that you did to support the revitalization of Manhattan's Chinatown. You have such a magical ability to bring people together in community through your joy and your vibrancy. Kexin and Jesse, there you are. I've said it to you 100 times, but because of the two of you, my composting game is so much stronger, and my family has been cooking healthier meals and wasting less, so I really appreciate that. So if you all see me leaving tonight, if you're all coming to the reception, if you all see me leaving tonight with leftovers, they're to blame. I brought some takeout, packaging to walk away. So, I'm doing the world a favor there. And then Krutika. Yeah, Krutika, you carried your work with ultimate grace and calm. Your steadfastness and dedication allowed you to pinpoint real and meaningful change on an individual, collective, and policy-changing level. So you're just an incredible advocate for the PCOS community. It's been such a pleasure to work with you. And last but not least is Effie. Effie, you win the award for having the most office hours with me. but no, really, the many hours that we got to spend together was a reflection, of the hard work and dedication that you put towards your community, and it was an homage to your family and yourself. The chance to be a social designer, that choice to be a social designer is not an easy one, and you can hear by, Alain's talk, how difficult it is to participate in this space. It involves fostering and holding meaningful relationships, informed advocacy, historical acknowledgement, self-awareness, and a ton of communication, care, and heart. Today, the class of 2023 will be sharing stories about preserving our cultures and histories, creating spaces for relationship building and relationship shifting, about self-advocacy and self-awareness, about safe spaces to be who we are, about the power of invisible worlds, and about the joy and the power of collectivity. Many of these stories originate from personal experiences and will be shared in ways that protect the identities of the communities affected by the social issues that you'll hear about today. So we invite all of you in the audience really to project your positive energy so that these students feel welcome, received, and held today. With that, I'm just going to wrap up so we can get the party started here. Let's kick off the presentations and invite our first presenter up, Pallavi.
Today, I just wanted to sit down and talk with you all. And before I get started, I want to preface that everything that I'm going to talk about today, I didn't do by myself. It took many, many villagers. Thank you so much. Thank you all for the friends that became family and the family that supported me always. And all of it was co-created, so thank you. I'm going to start where it all started for me. It started with a jacaranda tree. And I grew up in Delhi, and there was a jacaranda tree outside my parents' house. And that's kind of how I think of Delhi, and that's what I missed the most when I left. I had this strong connection with the tree. My parents told me that the monkey that lived on the tree was actually my parents, and that's where I came from. But beyond that, this is also Delhi. Delhi is the third largest city in the world. This is what it looked like in 1998. And this is it in 2018. So in the span of my own lifetime and of being in Delhi, you see how much the green turned into gray and how many more people moved in. And as the city grew and grew really fast and is still growing really fast, everyone needs water. But the city is water scarce, and so is the country overall. India has 14% of the world's population, but only 6%, nope, other way around, 16% of the world's population, but only 4% of the world's freshwater resources. And the amount of water available for each person is decreasing by about 30%. So there's this increase in number of people, but decrease in the amount of water available for each person, and everyone needs water. And then layered on top of that is a problem of the usage. So the Delhi Jal Board, or the DJB, they're the municipal board kind of in charge of cleaning, distributing the water around the city. And they imagine that about 170 liters for each person each day. That's kind of what they plan for. But research kind of shows that that actual usage is very different. Lower income households use as low as 20 liters per day, while higher income households use up to 450 liters per day for each person. So there are all these issues. There's the increase in demand, the decrease in supply, and this issue of overconsumption. And as I kind of started this project last year and trying to understand where I can really interact with it and where I can be as a social designer, I was really thinking of this issue of overconsumption. People are overusing water, and there isn't enough. So in what ways can we reduce that? How can we not use so much water when there isn't enough? And I started doing this research into the connection that people have with the environment. And it's kind of based on this idea of biophilia, which is people's innate desire to connect with nature. But what I realized beyond that, it's not just that people benefit from being in nature. It's not just like physical, emotional, and mental benefits from being in nature. The environment also benefits from people being more connected to the environment. Because when people aren't connected, there's this apathy. People don't care if there's degradation to the environment because you don't feel bonded to it. And this kind of happens in three ways: through affect, so how you feel towards nature; cognition, your thoughts and beliefs about nature; and behavior, how much time you spend in nature. And it got me thinking, this is kind of why I'm doing the project, right? That's me as a kid with the jacaranda tree. I was always connected to nature in odd ways, and that's why I'm here today. So how can I leverage this bi-directional connection, this benefit to the people and the environment, but apply it specifically to the issue of water? And I wanted to do this by connecting people to their natural water resources. So not just building connections to nature overall, but specifically to where your water comes from. So this project is about growing connections between people and their natural water source to build attitudes, behaviors, and practices of water sustainability. To break it down even further, it looks like the thesis goal of connecting people to their water sources to increase pro-environmental attitudes and behaviors, increase water conservation, less overconsumption, to tackle that really big goal that I talked in the beginning of all the problems around Delhi and the water supply. And I started doing this and did it in three main ways. So mapping, sharing, and sustaining. And I'm going to talk through all three of these in how much time I have left. So let's start with mapping. So this was really nice. I got to go back home. I got to go back to Delhi. I have to cough. I got to go back to Delhi, and I got to visit different water locations around the city. I got to talk. I have to cough again. So this journey has been a journey of me also getting sick before the presentation, besides all the other things that happened. So I went to Delhi. I went to different locations, and I talked with experts who kind of knew that was their job, they knew the science behind it, but then I also talked to people who had lived experience and had interacted with those water sources. I documented images and videos from those places and kind of gathered all the information that I could. The first place I went to was one that was very close to heart. It's Hoskas. Hoskas means royal tank. It's very close to my home where I grew up. And it was built in the 14th century, and it was used to collect water for all the residents of the Siri dynasty. And it isn't in use anymore, though it does help the natural ecosystem, because the more water that's in the tank kind of benefits all the other wells in the neighborhood, because there's an increase in groundwater. But what I found really important about this is that the issue of Delhi not having water is not a new one. Like, in the 14th century, they knew that Delhi's an arid climate. And when it rains, it's important to collect the water and save it for when there isn't enough water. And it's just a really beautiful place to go visit, too. The second place I went to was the Yamuna. It's a giant river, so I went to one place along the river. This river provides about 70% of all the water to Delhi. But when it enters the city, it loses its quality dramatically. 15 drains drain their water into the river. And the point where I went to was a barrage, so the image on the left is kind of where the water is held, and the water isn't flowing, and it's very dry. There were a couple cows grazing, as not uncommon in Delhi. And then the other side was lush and beautiful and green, where the water was flowing. And then the third place I was very fortunate to visit was the Okhla Water Treatment Plant. This is a treatment plant in Delhi that processes about 20 million gallons per day, which is the second largest treatment plant in the city. And it was made up, you can see in the image over there, like these huge uber, like they look like cereal bowls, like really large cereal bowls filled with water, and they go through different stages of processing. And they go through that kind of really muddy stage over there to, I'll show you the clean one in a second. But what really impressed me when I was there is the people that I met. I wasn't expecting that. Someone needs to be there 24/7 of the day. Like, someone is always monitoring the plant and the quality of the water. And everyone I spoke with at the plant were so excited and passionate about the work they did. There was so much pride in keeping the water clean for the city. And it was this kind of mix of European standards that they were following and this kind of art of like the humidity and the temperatures of Delhi and maintaining the water. So they took the water that's kind of cloudy over there and they transformed it into this. You can see all the way to the bottom of the tank. So now that I had mapped a few of the locations, I wanted to start sharing them with people who might be using too much water and talking to them about where their water comes from to build that connection. And this is where I got kind of one of those hiccups and things weren't working out as I had planned them to. I was trying to find a perfect arena to share this information, somewhere where we could talk about these places that felt comfortable. And then one day an aunt of mine came over, and my mom and I and my aunt, but lots of aunts come up in the story, but this is the first aunt, we were in the kitchen and we were making tea. And there was something so, so familiar about it. I feel like I've done it like 1,000 times in my life without paying attention to it. It's the smell of the tea. It's this red color of the tea. I remember my grandmother making tea. And that's when it came to me that my project could really be about tea. And I developed these things called Pani Ke Bare Mein Chai, or Tea About Water. And using teas and the lessons that I learned from that aunt and all the other aunties in this project and who have been in my life and my mom and everybody, to kind of leverage these existing systems to share about what I had learned and spread that wonder that I felt when I went to these different water locations. Because chais are a gathering space that has been co-designed, co-created, and iterated upon for generations. It's something that I've been studying in school, and it was this moment for me to go back home and be like, there are powerful aunties who have been doing this already, and there's so much I can learn from them too. And the chais that I hosted about water had three parts. The first was Betty. Please sit, so get comfortable, have some snacks, just settle down a little bit. Sometimes these would take longer than I had planned in my structured agendaness, and I learned that was okay because agendas don't really work for chais. Next was batchit or chit chat. I wanted to leverage kind of how when we were kids, we used to have like 4x6 printed glossy photographs after a family holiday, and just use an informal setting of the chai of like sharing pictures of the water places I'd been to and the stories that I'd heard, and use that kind of informal setting for it. And the last part was tofa, or a gift, and this was something to take away. This kind of looked like a little tag, that blue thing on the side, which had the date, who it was for, and who it was from, a checklist of water conservation practices that made sense for the neighborhood. The back sheet had kind of what we'd done in the chai, an overview, my looser agenda. And then there were these stickers that had images from the places I'd gone to that were meant to be placed on water access points, so placed on taps and water bottles to kind of bridge that gap from where your water is being used and from where it's actually coming from. And the last step is sustaining. And as this year comes to a close for us, and I start to step away a little bit for this project, I've been thinking about how it can live on beyond me going to thesis class every Monday. And from talking to the people, the aunties and others that I did the workshops with, it felt like a website was the best way to kind of hold all this information as a way for people to refer back on, to have all the stories that I talked about during the chai, or for someone to have a new chai, host a new chai themselves, so download the resources and hold a whole new one. So it's a website now, and it lives on whereisyourwaterfrom.webflow.io. And I'd like to end again with thanks. And thanks to the Ganga, thanks to the Yamuna, and thanks to the rainwater in the ground. Thank you.
Good afternoon, friends. First of all, before we get started, I'd like to introduce myself. Hi, I'm Brittany. I use you she, her pronouns. And good afternoon. Thank you so much for being here today with us as we gather to celebrate and share the work that we've poured our hearts and souls into for the last 2 years. Before we begin, I'd like to hold a moment of gratitude for all of the wonderful people that have contributed to this work. I could not have done this alone, and I forever appreciate the time and care that all of you have shared with me throughout the course of the project. You are the reason that this project has made it this far, and you are the reason that this work will continue after graduation. I'm here today to talk to you about a social and public health issue very close to my heart, which is hearing health. Hearing loss is one of the most prevalent conditions affecting Americans today. People with a recorded hearing loss or barrier to sound may also identify as deaf or hard of hearing. Historically, deafness has been defined by medical diagnoses and terms, but these are not the only things that define how people access sound. Hearing and deafness is more of a spectrum, and people access sound differently. So I'm making a decision here to explore more open and inclusive language around sound and hearing health, with the goal of holding space for people like myself that are navigating the in-betweens. You may not be able to tell at first glance, but I identify as hard of hearing. I have a mild, moderate hearing loss, and I use hearing aids in some settings to help me access sound. My mother, my closest and dearest friend, also wears hearing aids, and she has for many, many years. She began to notice a difference in her hearing levels in high school, beginning her hearing journey at a young age. It was very challenging for her, often isolating and straining on social relationships. Because of her experience, she was proactive in getting my hearing tested every year. And luckily, I was fitted with hearing aids, but after that, I was essentially thrown to the wind. I wasn't quite sure how to go about navigating the emotions that I was feeling, having learned that I would be experiencing the world differently than I had grown accustomed to. About 5 years into my journey, I have just begun to embrace my identity as a hard of hearing person, embracing my hearing journey, asking for help, and wearing my hearing aids. I'm learning to speak up about my hearing needs with peers, and I've begun navigating my identity as a young hard of hearing person, but it was only after dedicating time to some serious self-reflection and noticing, seeking out resources, and speaking to other people with hearing loss that I began to really step into my identity. Of the 48 million Americans with a recorded hearing loss, there are approximately 15 million that do not seek any sort of assistance, and those that do typically wait an average of 7 years to do so. So why is this gap important? This delay in seeking assistance becomes problematic when we look at the long-term effects of hearing loss. According to Johns Hopkins Medicine, social isolation encouraged by hearing loss can cause deaf and hard of hearing folks to be more likely to experience anxiety and depression. And later in life, hearing loss can also place folks at greater risk for brain atrophy and dementia. This is because the longer a hearing loss goes unnoticed or untreated, the greater loss of sound discrimination skills, or the ability to differentiate and distinguish between different sounds. In this case especially, if you don't use it, you lose it. Now, because of this, I wondered, why are folks waiting so long to seek assistance? What are the internal and external barriers that they may be experiencing, and what can we do? What tools and experiences can we create to help folks recognize and challenge these barriers? I knew my personal journey and experiences, but I wanted to learn from other folks about hearing loss. Although I am a stakeholder, I couldn't base my project off of my own biases and assumptions. In my research, I collected stories from 44 other people, some with hearing loss, some without. And the survey responses, coupled with several interviews, confirmed that my personal experiences and challenges finding resources and community early in my hearing journey was not uncommon among others with hearing loss. From my research, I've identified the following insights and opportunities. Teens and young adults in particular are an underserved group by existing organizations and resources. 1 in 5 teens have some degree of hearing loss, but existing organizations connect best with children and older adults. Because of this, there's an opportunity to reach out to this community of people in need, especially as they begin to learn about taking control of their own health. People are rarely aware of emergent changes in their sound access due to lack of testing and lack of reflection. Unless their physicians are proactively testing for hearing loss, which less than 16% do, it's impossible for people to know if they may benefit from help. So how can we expect them to seek out assistance if they don't know that they might benefit from it? Current practices, tools, and languages often subscribe to a medical model of disability that is polarizing and confines deafness to just medical diagnoses and terms. So there's an opportunity here to design with care to center deafness as a spectrum existing beyond a clinical diagnosis and focus on more holistic reflection around the role of sound in our lives. And finally, most Americans do not approach the topics of sound access or hearing health with openness, if at all. So there's a huge opportunity here to encourage more discussion around access to sound and deafness, to foster more openness around the topic. And so I wonder, how might we empower young people in the United States to challenge barriers to sound access at early stages of their hearing journeys and beyond by fostering a greater sense of openness around hearing health? I settled on a collection of goals for whatever the intervention might be: to design an experience centered around sound that young people feel is worthy of sharing with their peers, to showcase and celebrate lived experiences of folks with hearing loss, to engage with young people and hold space for them to reflect on the role of sound in their lives, to share tools and frameworks that encourage more holistic reflection and open dialogue around sound access and hearing health, and demonstrate deafness, hearing, and access to sound as a spectrum through the use of inclusive language and the sharing of experiences in a safe environment, and of course, to jumpstart new hearing journeys. After much research and consideration, I settled on a concept for an intervention, which is Find Your Frequency, a series of gatherings organized to facilitate open dialogue, reflection, and curiosity around hearing health and the role of sound in our lives, supplemented by an online community dubbed the Resonation. In testing the prototype, I hosted 2 digital gatherings and 1 in-person gathering with an intended audience of young adults ages 17 to 35 with an interest in exploring the role of sound in their lives, but anyone with an interest in hearing health and sound access was welcome to participate. So, what makes this particular intervention different? Find Your Frequency targets a demographic that is essentially unreachable by current efforts, rejects the medical model and polarized definition of deafness, and creates a space for talking with rather than at community with a focus on connection, and encourages more holistic reflection around sound access. In preparing for the event, I made a flyer, which I rezo printed and distributed around SVA online and through my personal network. And I was really struggling to get some responses at first. So in an effort to get more people to come to the event, I set up a little sign in the library and sat there with a bag of candy to try and get people to come and talk. And I actually ended up getting a participant through this strategy, which was really exciting. For the digital gatherings, I leveraged free online tools like Google Meet and Figma that provided video conferencing, captions, and other modes of collective creation. The gatherings walked participants through introductions for trust building, a core discussion, and finally a closing reflection. And I found that the groups of 5 to 6 that I worked with were a great size for these small group discussions. People were able to get a little bit vulnerable, and everybody had an opportunity to share their perspective on each discussion question. The in-person gathering was a curated experience with 4 different activities created in SVA Library West with the goal of meeting young people where they are to focus on connecting them around sound access. So the activities were constructed in a loop, much like a journey, and people were invited to cycle through the conversation corner, free hearing assessment station, story gallery, and the end of experience reflection. So I'm gonna do a quick little walkthrough of these different activities now. The conversation corner was guided by cards with prompts and questions. And the main goal here was to hold space for conversation and connection and see if there was an opportunity to open some people's eyes to the importance of hearing health, especially in young people. Then folks were invited to visit the hearing assessment station where there were instructions on how to access an existing free hearing assessment resource. And the goal here was to increase the number of assessments completed and encourage more reflection around individual hearing levels and how people communicate with each other. And then there was the story gallery where I posted some of the stories that I had collected from the community and people just provided an opportunity to share and honor lived experiences for people with hearing loss and encourage those that were reading these stories to add their own and reflect on how sound has impacted their life. And then finally, at the end, I invited people to share an end of experience reflection so that it was a reflection moment for them and they could contemplate on how the experience influenced them. And then it also helped me understand how the experience affected them and allowed me to evaluate the prototypes that I could iterate on it. So evaluating the impact of this, I was very pleasantly surprised with the feedback, and the prototype succeeded in creating a space and experience that sparked curiosity and action, established new connections and conversations around hearing health and sound access among the participants, and also increased awareness and openness around hearing health among all the event participants. So this work must continue, and it's very important, and so I'm making sure that it does. Looking forward, I'm going to continue sharing the work in settings such as these. I'll be collaborating continuously with my community partner, HLAA, and sharing this work at their June meeting. I'm hoping to collaborate with more organizations. I'm currently pursuing discussions with SVA's Disability Resources Center to hopefully work with them on some programming for the fall. And aspiring for scalability, I think if this goes well here at SVA, I'd love to bring it into other professional development programs, possibly high schools and other institutions of higher education. And of course, as I continue this work, I'm still on my own hearing journey. So I'll be continuing to explore what hearing health and sound access mean to me and continuing to share that with the world and all of you. Thank you so much for your time today.
My friends, work home. Before my presentation, I want to ask you all a question. Have you ever felt the power of unity and culture in a community? I have. Today, I'm going to tell you a story about Manhattan Chinatown. My name is Mo Hui Sun. In 2021, I traveled from Dalian, China to New York City. Like many international students, I felt lonely during the pandemic, particularly as a non-native English speaker. As I long for my hometown, I enjoy spending time in Manhattan's Chinatown. But after the pandemic, I have noticed this has become increasingly quiet and deserted. Manhattan Chinatown was formed in the 1870s. One of the largest and oldest Chinese community in the U.S. Within over 67 residents, COVID-19 has led the most severe unemployment crisis in Manhattan Chinatown. As a result, the impact of the pandemic has been felt by the whole community, including families, small business, and residents of all age, which is why it's crucial that we work toward making a change. At that moment, I feel I have to do something about it. Chinatown is important. As it helps local business grow, giving needed support to residents and teaching native-born Americans about other cultures. They are especially vital for low-income folks, immigrants, and small businesses, and depend on these communities for their well-being. So what I'm focused on these two groups. I want to explore how to help them address the problem about social disconnection, diminished and culture vibrance, and struggling local businesses. With that in mind, over the past year, I began spending more time in this community. A food pantry delivery person is my first step toward getting to know them. Within time goes on, my identity changed a lot. I become a community researcher and eventually hosting community events. During my time in the community, I had a memorable encounter that opened my eyes to the real impact of the pandemic on Chinatown. I met two Chinese ladies, Auntie Li and Auntie Wang. They felt lonely and disconnected after the pandemic because they were few activities, talks, and fun things to do. They missed the vibrant old days when Chinatown was full of life. How my way sparked a sense of belonging and a social spark. While igniting interest in the local businesses to facilitate the vibrant recovery for Manhattan Chinatown community. Now, let's explore the need of people, support local business, and review Chinatown with our first prototype. Once I was trying to rebranding a local barber shop in Chinatown to bring back old customer and attract new ones after the pandemic. But I realized that I couldn't address the social issue with the rebranding alone. So I teamed up with the Chinatown Business Improvement District, building on their open street program. Together with the volunteers, we offered culture activities like painting classes, origami, and balloon art to draw more participants in, and courses access to local social activities. I also took these opportunities to research what the community members wanted from these activities. The success of this approach empowered me to create a community event platform that connects people to the Chinatown community through culture. Today, I'm happy to introduce you all my final intervention, the Spark Igniters, which is a platform to bring Chinatown together with art, culture, and service. It helps local business and makes the community lively again after the pandemic. We connect people and create support for each other. As an organizer, this year, my classmate Ife Tan and I found an Asian art organization called as a main host of Spark Igniters. We collaborate with more potential art groups to bring diverse art experience and a stronger community connection to Chinatown. The goal of the project is to empower Chinatown small business, enhancing community resilience, and foster inclusive economic development. In our first event, our weekend successfully collaborated with over 70 talented artists, bringing an amazing culture events to community in attracted more than 3,000 visitors and made over 50,000 in sales. You can enjoy traditional music, art, experience Asian life here. The mission attracted over 2,000 volunteers and we are constantly building community cohesion. We bond this successful back to the community and as the IR become more well-known, more greater communication contact us and bond more vitality to the community. For example, we work with the New York Mandarin Playback Theater to bring proud art to a senior center, allowing more seniors to tell their story and participate in a performance and in a easily way. Next month, you all see this exciting performance on the open street stage. We also invite artists from the New York Chinese Traditional Theater Association for performance. In this picture, this is a Chinese traditional musical instruments, guzheng performance. This artist attract a large number of tourists. More tourists means more food traffic, boosts small business. Well, people have fun. We also make a social service more accessibly. This is including language service, healthcare, legal aid, civic information, small business support. Through Spark Igniters, we aim to create a more inclusive and resilient community in Chinatown, enhancing social cohesion, promoting local art and culture, and strengthening local businesses. Now, more and more Asian businesses have been inspired to invent in the community. I'm thrilled to share some exciting news. I've already cured over 2,000 in sponsorship from ACRE. In serving over our activities can continue to thrive, and a lot of really amazing artists and organizations join us. Today, you also hear more exciting story about we are from other students. Let's come together to create a thriving community, united for a vibrant Chinatown and be the spark that ignites a positive change. And thank you for hearing. Finally, I'd like to express my deep gratitude to everyone who has supported me on this journey. My heartfelt thanks to my advisor, Mari, and the whole DSI team, Mia, Dimitri, Carolyn, and Gail. Thanks to my community and my supportive partner Chinatown BID, and thanks my classmate and the last certainly not least, thanks my mom to support me in this journey. And in the heart of Manhattan, let's ignite breaking and hope and resilience as we together to breathe life back into the vibrant Chinatown community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mohair. That was amazing. All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome, and thank you for joining us on a really warm and beautiful spring day. My name is Kritika. I use she, her pronouns, and I am thrilled to be sharing my work with my amazing and super talented classmates and friends. And so today, I would just like to invite you all into a conversation. And I often like to begin my presentations by grounding us in a quote. And today, I have one from Katie Cannon, which reads, "Our bodies are the texts that carry the memories, and therefore remembering is no less than reincarnation." So today I'll be talking to you about issues around health equity, access to healthcare, and quality of life for individuals identifying as women. The World Health Organization defines quality of life as an individual's perception of their position in life in the context of the culture and value systems in which they live, and in relation to their goals, expectations, standards, and concerns. Now, that felt a bit wordy, but insufficient at the same time. I reflected on this and thought about that, you know, probably the most important definition of quality of life should perhaps be the one that a patient provides while sitting across from their doctor. So one such condition that severely affects the quality of life of 1 in 10 women in the US is PCOS, or polycystic ovary syndrome, which is a hormonal and metabolic condition. The numbers are estimated to be much higher because 70% of individuals do go undiagnosed. PCOS is a leading cause of infertility in women, and about 50% of these individuals will become diabetic before the age of 40. This condition also has other comorbidities such as endometrial cancer, cardiovascular diseases, anxiety and depression, and much more. The numbers are on the rise, and the economic burden of this condition is estimated at $8 billion annually. Despite the discovery of this condition almost 90 years ago, currently there is no FDA-approved cure or cause for this condition. So while these are just some facts and figures, when I conducted my research, I discovered some emerging themes that affected an individual on a range from social to personal relationships. Socially, an individual may experience isolation because of the stigma and shame associated with this condition. Further, the care delivery is extremely fragmented, and on an individual level, a person faces tough challenges such as body dysmorphia and eating disorders. Now, for a minute, I want you to imagine that you are a plant in a desert trying to survive. Your resources are limited, and you are in isolation. Rainwater is scarce, and it is always hot and dry. That is what PCOS feels like. To always try and survive in conditions that don't support growth and nourishment. But there's always a response. Human bodies, like plants, adapt and evolve. The PCOS experience is similar. The body has to learn to find ways to thrive even in the harshest conditions. If I had to describe PCOS, it is like a cactus. Prickly, oddly shaped, hard to touch, painful, but also resilient and strong. And I know this experience well enough because I am the 1 in 10 women living with this condition for the last 13 years. To better understand the stakeholders involved, I mapped the ecosystem of care delivery for PCOS, which involves support on an individual, provider, and community level. An individual navigating the healthcare system in the US may face several challenges, from identifying needs to connecting to support. When a system is broken, how might we find ways to heal? To explore this thought further, I decided to focus on the significance of social relationships and how community support can help these individuals. The question I wanted to address with my thesis was, how might we co-create a dialogue that empowers individuals with PCOS to advocate for their needs in social and civic spaces? This work has been in collaboration with my community partner, PCOS Challenge, the largest nonprofit dedicated to PCOS in the US based out of Atlanta, Georgia. They work at the intersection of healthcare providers, receivers, civic systems, research, and development. With them, I conducted three key research initiatives, which included stakeholder mapping, qualitative interviews, and co-design workshops. On this journey, I have had many learnings. I have learned about the importance of community and amplifying the voices of that community members. I decided to focus on a subset of the population within this space. One are the empowered super advocates who have been leading a patient-driven movement, and then there's the newly diagnosed individuals who are looking for support. The following slide shares the voices of these folks. These co-creators helped shed light on some key emotions and actions surrounding this cause. Reassurance, advocacy, social support, and care were some themes that repeatedly showed up in these conversations. At this point of reflection, I wanted to go deeper into the themes of empowerment, confidence, and advocacy. And which brings me to this quote by Shirley Chisholm that reads, "If they don't give you a seat at the table, bring a folding chair." I explored the theme of advocacy. What did that look like in health and civic spaces? This definition felt the closest. Identifying, embracing, and promoting a cause, advocacy can influence public opinion as well as public policy. I sat with that definition and decided to map what advocacy could look like on a scale of relationships again. Looking at these axes of relationship to self and relationship to others versus activities that require internal reflection and activities that require external collaboration, I mapped a set of tools that could aid this journey into healing. I designed tools for advocacy at the self, peer, and legislative levels. And with that, I'd like to introduce my intervention, Seasons of Sisterhood. Seasons of Sisterhood is about discovering moments of transformation and healing through PCOS advocacy, storytelling, and relationships. The concept is a metaphor for how our bodies go through different seasons, and that every season demands a different way to adapt. From the foods we eat to the relationships we hold close, how might we thrive in each season? The intervention currently has two parts to it, tools for self-advocacy and for legislative advocacy that I intend to develop further. The self-advocacy part helps an individual connect with their identity as a PCOS patient and empowers them to claim their narrative as an advocate. The legislative advocacy tool talks about the impact of community action in health policy. It is an educational piece that invites the reader into the legislative process and guides them to take action through activities such as writing a letter to your local legislation. This tool will be further developed alongside my community partner for promoting PCOS advocacy at the state and federal levels. Finally, this intervention aims to create conditions for growth for individuals with PCOS through empowerment, care, and nourishment. And it really creates this space for time and reflection and for engaging in community action so that we may be able to thrive and grow even in the harshest conditions and contribute to the desert in nourishing ways. And so I'd like to leave you with one last thought. Spring has just begun here in the Northern Hemisphere, but what season does it feel like in your mind and body? Thank you.
Hi. Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here. Hello, everyone. My name is Effie Tam. Today, I want to share with you a group of wonderful people who I thought I can start helping as a designer, but ended up learning so much more from them through their resilience. They are the elderly Chinese immigrants. I see their story of building connection to the city as nothing less than a superhero legends. Decades ago, despite arriving in the city with barely a word of English and little understanding of the US culture, they formed hometown association to support each other. Limited job opportunity makes them more united and build more strong unions. Together, they build their own support network, rooting themselves in the city, raising next generation, and taking pride as New Yorker. But I also noticed that as they have aged, the legend of building connection with the city faced new challenge. Among Asian community in New York, Chinese population has the highest proportion of seniors and is growing really fast. Many of them are live alone and do not have daily contact with family, friends they don't live with. Half of them live in poverty and have English and technology barriers. All of this make them at a higher risk of isolation and result in poor health outcome. But they remain the resilient individual they have always been. This made me wonder, how might we bring this community's incredible resilience back to build connection and improve their quality of life in New York? For a long time, the support system they built worked really well in helping them build connection in the US society. However, as they retired, work-related social interaction fade away, unions and hometown association are outdated, and their families move away. Today, community-based organization has stepped up to be their social hubs and resource connector. Yet, despite their resources, I keep hearing them say that they want more independence in building connection. In their words, this means not having to wait for a community center visit to understand an English message or get the latest information on medication and activities. And do community-based organizations know that? Absolutely. But they also face limited resource funding and staff, which make them hard to cope with the needs. So the question we are left with is, how might we utilize existing resources within community-based organizations to effectively boost the elderly Chinese immigrants' self-sufficiency and independence in building connection in New York? Let me introduce you my amazing community partner, Manikander Center. They are a respected community-based organization in Lower East Side, working on reducing the elderly social isolation and enhancing their well-being. Together, we decided to focus on the English and technology course. These are the most common courses offered by many senior centers, and we can see the great potential of how this can help seniors build connections. Right now, the courses face two challenges. First, it's hard to find materials that are designed for seniors, making the course less engaging and hard to for the seniors to keep pace with. Second, the course is hard to digest when we only shown the how but missing out on explaining the why. One senior in technology course said, when learning a new script instead of understanding the letters, I'm merely just drawing characters. So, to develop a course that meets Chinese seniors' need in building connection and is easy to learn, we came up with three prototypes. The first one was a Go design workshop asking seniors to imagine a life free from English and technology barriers. The storytelling really opens them up. Hui Jin wants to read medication instruction by herself, and Catherine wants to find Italian restaurant nearby. Xiaoying want to greet the volunteers she's grateful to. These are small, right? But with their words, we understand how this are big step toward the independence and connection they desired. Next, we try to break down the complexity, so we make the set of field in the blank card to help them customize daily English expression to their real life scenario. But more than that, the card sparked them to share their unique ways of learning complex ideas. Their own cultural background and concept familiar to them really help. It reminds us that the culture we carry continue to be our powerful learning tools throughout our lives. The third prototype was the customized task card designed to be used before every class. For example, in Google Map learning class, by putting down where they want to go and the information they need about it, it transformed their in-class exercise into real-life practice. So now, let me share our final intervention. Unlocking the Golden Years, a senior center's curriculum that is co-designed by and for elderly Chinese immigrants. It starts with a Go design workshop and select course content to facilitate the connection that the seniors want to build. Next, by breaking down their goals into practical tasks and give cultural relevance explanation, the course leverages their existing knowledge to unlock the new. Third, each class starts with the customized tech card and end with a test car, takeaway car. This allows seniors get to practice what they want to achieve in class and able to bring it beyond the classroom. After that, by learning from the seniors' notes, we improve the course by adding more cultural relevance explanation that make more sense to the seniors. Overall, when we say seniors central design, we mean it's designed by, but not designed for. It's about enhancing their self-efficacy for expanding connection. It's about providing practical solution facing daily scenarios. It's about emphasizing what they can do with the knowledge and experience they already have. It's about transforming connection-built skills into real-life practice. So far, we have co-designed 5 lessons with Chinese seniors and conduct 2 rounds of the curriculum at the center and make our seniors participate more connected with service, activities, and people. Remember Catherine, she found her 2 Italian restaurants in the class and invite her family to grow. Looking ahead, I see the potential for our course to not only help more Chinese seniors, but also the other elderly immigrants from diverse backgrounds in New York in building connection. But let's dream even bigger. Imagine if we could extend this senior-centered design approach to more service. We could make our system a place that facilitates seniors to interact with the world in the way they desired, not only for today's senior, but also for future generation, for you and me. During my thesis journey, I got, and I know this is, not only a dream, And during my thesis journey, I got an invitation from the Life Story Club, an NGO reducing social isolation and loneliness among seniors in New York, to co-design program for Chinese senior. So we are on the way. Looking back, I'm filled with gratitude to the resilient seniors who taught me that starting from small is not a weakness, but a strength. To the community-based organization for being the connection in our community. To my DS, my family, to my friends, for your unwavering support, and to my family for your endless love. Age doesn't diminish our capacity to connect, learn, and contribute. Let's continue to empower and be empowered in the city, living life as we desire. Thank you. Let's welcome Ikun!
Oh my god, I'm sweating. Hello everyone, I'm Ikun. I use he, him pronouns. Today, I'd like to invite you all to step inside my diary, out, within, and beyond. I come from a large traditional Chinese family. Each spring festival, we like to put up some red banner outside the door, which symbolizes harmony and prosperity within the household. But every time as I walk under those banners, I can't help but feel a sense of pressure. As a Chinese man, I got a script of filial piety. I'm expected to uphold my family honor, provide stability, and continue the family line by getting married and having children. However, as a Chinese gay child, this script changed a lot. This script conflicts with my true self, with who I love, and with my desire for companionship and emotional fulfillment. I'm not alone in this struggle. There are 56% of Chinese LGBTQ population face discrimination within their family, leading 84% of Chinese gay men to marry straight women, and 42% have contemplated or even attempted suicide to escape these conflicts. You know, in Chinese culture, family is everything, but things are changing. The modern relationships are different and challenging this old belief. A growing movement of modern filial piety has emerged, in which people try to find a balance between personal happiness and family expectation. When I was 23rd, I met Oliver. He took me to eat a cheesecake, and we were into a relationship 2 months later. It was a really good cheesecake. But a year later, we broke up since his family put so much pressure on him to get married. Definitely, it made me really sad. But growing up, whenever I felt sad, my younger sister was always the one I liked to lean on for support. That day, I found her lounging on a beanbag chair, watching Modern Family. She glanced at me and said, "Bro, I'm watching Modern Family. Can't talk now." I didn't care what she was doing. I just walked it over and sat down and tearfully told her, "Vera, I have something to tell you. I'm gay." She immediately turned off the iPad, sat up straight, and I bet in that moment her older brother tearfully coming out to her was more exciting than any episode of Modern Family. My sister just rolled her eyes and said, "I know. Because every time you think Gaga's born this way in your room every day." Then she shrugged and said, "It's not a big deal. But if you're going to be gay, at least be a cool gay. Don't worry about what others think. Just be yourself and embrace who you are." My sister, she's brave, she's kind, she's nice, and she's here. She's crying. This time, her turn to cry. So my sister inspired me to bravely take the first step towards self-acceptance and let me understand my happiness and authenticity were just as important as fulfilling my duty as a son and a brother. So today, what I'm going to talk about is how might we foster a more inclusive and compassionate understanding of family dynamic to bridge the gap between traditional cultural expectation and the personal identity of Chinese gay men. After realizing the importance of self-acceptance, I feel inspired to do something about it, to help other persons who might be struggling with a similar issue. And I had the incredible opportunity to volunteer as an event planner at the Chinese Rainbow Network, an organization based in the United States dedicated to supporting LGBTQ community. And over the past 2 years, I have conducted extensive interviews and I engaged with participants in two co-creation sections by utilizing my two prototypes, the coming out simulator and the conversation card. Through my interview and co-creation, I've come to realize that we all have our unique path to self-discovery and acceptance. Our story may be different, but our struggle and triumph unite us. Therefore, I have learned that the community engagement and narrative communication can be a powerful tool for promoting understanding and empathy. It creates a sense of shared experience and helps us to break down the barrier often divide us. So today, I'm thrilled to introduce you all the Tea Talk Gathering, an innovative intervention that aims to create a safe and supportive space for Chinese gay men to openly discuss their experience. This gathering is open to both out and closet individuals who have struggled with this conflict relationship. Our hope is that through this conversation, participants will gain insights into their experience, develop coping strategy, and build stronger relationship with themselves and their family. The gathering begins with a consent form, ensuring that everyone feels comfortable and respected throughout the event. This is followed by an ice-breaking activity to help them get to know each other. Next, evaluating action section is led by the psychology expertise to provide guidance and support for the participant. But one unique aspect of the Tea Talk Gathering is the collaboration between out person and closet person. The out person are invited to share their experience, while closet person are given the opportunity to share their struggles. This collaboration provides a diverse of perspective and resources, making the solution more targeted and effective. So far, the Tea Talk Gathering have been hosted 6 times. I was deeply moved by the story shared during the gathering. But I wonder, and I struggle with, how to preserve and share this powerful story. Therefore, another intervention that I'm excited to share with you all today is the graphic novel series, Coming Out, Coming Home. The graphic novel is the result of the conversation that happened in our gathering. It explores various paths of self-discovery and acceptance, and offer a powerful message of self-empowerment and reconciliation. The novel featured 2 stories of men who choose to come out to their family and 2 stories of men who choose not to. The purpose of the story is to illustrate that there's no right or wrong answer when it comes to coming out, but rather the most important thing is for individual to be true to themselves and find self-acceptance. And If they would like to, they can send me their illustration and a brief description of their journey. Their story will be added to my growing collection of the story and may even inspire others who are facing similar challenges during our gathering. As I look back on the result of my intervention, both T-Talk gathering and the graphic novel have made a positive impact. I helped it bring 45 people together in our community and engage them in conversation around self-acceptance. And the T-Talk gathering have become a regular series in our organization, Chinese Rainbow Network. And for the graphic novel, I'm happy to share that I've completed the book proposal. And I'm currently in discussion with the publisher to think about how to bring this novel to the world. I feel like I'm lucky. I witnessed so many touching and deeply personal stories. 2 months ago, I received a message from Victor, who has been a regular participant in our events. He shared that he successfully came out to his parents, and finally, he can live in the light, not the darkness. I cannot express how moved I was when I received that message. I'm grateful that he allowed me to share his story with you all today. Victor told me that if his story can just inspire just one person, it would be worth it. Well, we've made progress in empowering individuals and building a community. The journey toward improving the experience of Chinese gay men and their family is a complex and ongoing one. To move forward, we need to bring our families and trust and network into the conversation too. According to peer research, if LGBTQ individuals got family support, the suicide rate will drop from 42% to 6%. To achieve this, I'm partnering with the Chinese Rainbow Network to launch a new upcoming initiative called Free Parents Hug, which aims to provide a safe space for parents to learn about and support their LGBTQ children. In conclusion, coming back to my journey as a Chinese gay child, I'm still going through this process, and I haven't been able to talk with my parents about my identity. But 2 months ago, I went back to China and had a life-changing conversation with them. We talked about our hope and expectation. And my mother, who has been always sensitive to my emotion, she sent that something weighing heavily on me. But at that moment, she just said, no matter what happened and no matter who you are, as a mother, I will always choose my children. Thank you. As I share with you my journey so far, I would like to take a moment to express my gratitude to everyone who has shared their story with me throughout this journey. Your courage and vulnerability have inspired and motivated me to continue working toward creating a more inclusive and accepting society. And I want to say thank you to my advisor for your guidance and support throughout this journey. To my family, I want to say thank you for always being there with me and supporting me in everything I do. And I love my homeland, China. The Chinese traditional culture endows a special significance and value to the concept of family. That's a thing I will never forget and abandon. At the end, I hope each LGBTQ individual, I hope you can live your life out, delve deep within yourself, and venture beyond the societal expectation. Remember, Alice Bill Kuge. Thank you. thanks for listening for the first half presentation, and let's do a 10-minute break and then come back, but please stay tuned for the next following incredible presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome back. We hope you had like a good 10-minute break, and we're really excited to share the next set of presentations with you all. This work certainly would have been impossible without the unseen people that have been a part of it. I'm grateful to my community and my community partner, my absolutely magical friends, my family, my parents, my partner, and all of those that continue being a part of this work. I appreciate you. As we begin, I would like to acknowledge that the space I've been working in has made me more cognizant of the language I use. However, I appreciate if there's any feedback that you might have as well. My thesis presents and talks about neurodiversity and topics relating to it that could feel intense and heavy. If you do feel overwhelmed and you need to step out, please do so as you take care of yourself. What is neurodiversity? It's the idea that people experience and interact with the world around them in many different ways, and where differences are not viewed as deficits. It refers to the diversity of all people and is often used in the context of neurological or developmental conditions. My thesis focuses on ADHD, which stands for Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder. It's been recorded to impact approximately 11% of children and almost 5% of adults in the US, according to a 2017 CDC survey, and has since been on the rise. Amongst those 5%, my thesis focuses on adult women living with ADHD. In the process of defining the term women, there lies the nuance of identity. So in terms of gender identity, my thesis looks at any person who, regardless of their sex assigned at birth, identifies as a woman. While the actual number of people presenting symptoms of ADHD are similar by gender, males are almost 3 times more likely to be diagnosed with ADHD than females. This often happens as the markers of an ADHD diagnosis are consistently associated with the symptoms presented by and recorded in males. Lingering stereotypes, referral bias, hormonal fluctuations, and various other factors have complicated the presentation of ADHD in women, making it harder to be recognized. The unintended consequences of this has left a generation of women forced to internalize their symptoms, thinking of traits like inattentiveness, disorganization, or carelessness as personal flaws, rather than issues that require medical attention. This manifests in social, personal, and psychological ways, affecting an individual's growth, education, relationships, and sense of self, ultimately affecting their quality of life. The representation of an ADHD diagnosis needs to diversify, not dilute. ADHD is feeling like you're always behind, afraid of being seen as lazy and overworking to compensate until you burn out in the blaze of glory. This is an accurate description of ADHD masking and rings true for almost all the lived experiences in this ecosystem. Looking closer at these relationships, we can see how people are affected at different stages and in varying capacities. The core is where women living with ADHD sit. Just outside that, they have their immediate network, friends, family, co-workers, etc. Beyond all of this is the unknown and the unseen. In the shadows lie larger systems at play that include healthcare, education, civic systems, and many more. This ecosystem grows every time a new individual discovers the diagnosis and becomes a part of the community. My research insights provided me with various opportunities that I could design within, out of which I chose to create in the space of self-advocacy, awareness, and systems for self-discovery. Leading me to my guiding question, how might we design to reimagine and reintroduce self-expression as a form of self-care for women living with ADHD in order to contribute to a stronger sense of self and better quality of life? I had the honor of working alongside strong, thoughtful, and kind women who express willingness to learn, share experiences, and design collaboratively. Our conversations were enlightening and reaffirming. Rachel Dietkes, who is a licensed clinical social worker and the founder of Social Workers Who Design, was kind enough to agree to review any material before it went out into the community in order to ensure that the language and content was trauma-informed. My community partner, Katie Weber, is the founder of Women and ADHD, an online community that provides women living with ADHD, diagnosed or undiagnosed, the space and opportunity to connect. A lot of my work was informed by the insights I gathered by being a part of this, and allowed me to participate in conversation, extend, and receive support. It's humbling to witness the reverberation of experiences in community that serves as a reminder to recognize the ways in which what we say and do affects systems, places, and people around us. There's a lot of talk and encouragement to practice self-care, but a lot of the burden still falls on the individual. What currently exists in the space is an excess of tools targeted to increase productivity and maximize for efficiency in order to help with scheduling, organizing, focusing, etc. However, these tools, when not designed with care, send a message of inadequacy in individuals living with ADHD, forcing them to adapt into a system that creates more problems than it solves, and often trivializes the condition and lived experience. This isn't a personal failure, it's a systemic letdown. We need to know better in order to do better. As Dr. Lauren rightly notes, let's use our expertise for more than just getting people to be good little worker bees. The question isn't about how to fix ADHD. The real challenge lies in asking, exploring, and accounting for neurodivergent individuals when we design and create. The very nature of ADHD makes it impossible to have one right solution. We're always innovating and creating. My intervention centers self-care and expression in order to learn being kinder, offering compassionate and patience to yourself for all that you are, and not resentment for the things that you're not. I'm mindful about not creating another tool that adds to the burden experienced daily by neurodivergent individuals. Born from this intent and vision was Moody Boards, a space to exercise self-expression as a form of self-care. It allows you to explore and build a practice to process your feelings through visuals, images, colors, shapes, etc. Most people living with ADHD experience emotions intensely, and having an outlet helps with understanding, processing, and regulating these emotions. The process can be described in three simple steps: identify, introspect, and iterate. We start with a grounding check-in, featuring the wonderful feelings wheel created by Dr. Gloria Wilcox. Here, we identify the three things that we're feeling at the moment and make note of them. Next, we introspect and look for images and visuals that invoke the same feeling, while simultaneously creating the Moody board. And finally, we iterate. These are some of the boards created by people during our sessions. Each of them interpreted it in their own unique way as they created them. Moody boards was created with the intent of personal expression and exploration, but if chosen, can also be used to show someone what you want to say instead of just telling them. This currently lives digitally to be used and shared online in order to make designing a community-informed approach. By coming back to this whenever words fail us, we slowly start building the act of self-expression into a practice. We often think productivity means to work. It doesn't. Productivity means to make intentional choices towards a goal. The choice could be to pause, and the goal could be to replenish. Productivity could mean to rest. I envision this as a building block for increased communication and in order to better understand ADHD. Using it in the same way we use language, songs, letters, or just about anything to communicate with each other. It could also be a way to share with your partners, family members, or others what your ADHD looks like in order for there to be space for mutual support, understanding, and care in relationships. It's been heartbreaking to see, know, and listen to the experiences of people in community, with most of them feeling like they've lost time due to inadequate care, awareness, and resources. My intervention is an exercise that centers self-expression and prioritizes self-care. It aims to remind us that self-care isn't selfish and self-expression is essential. In a world where productivity and progress at the cost of self is accepted as the norm, there lies value and power in reclamation and reinvention. The work that I've had the opportunity to learn from and build on has a long way to go before it can rest. But when I do look around me, I see all the people who care show up and keep working relentlessly to create a future they wish they had. This quote felt fitting as I continue thinking about the future of this work. The best thing I've done for my ADHD is cut myself slack. It's not planners or medication or productivity hacks. It's recognizing that the world is hard for me to be around, and I need to support myself through it with self-compassion. Self-care is honoring your needs. It's saying no. And it's giving yourself the grace to show up as you are. Thank you.
All right, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sophia, and today I am excited to share my thesis work with you all, exploring perinatal mental health. This project was conceived out of a desire to understand how design can facilitate the creation of pathways to empower perinatal individuals in the transition to parenthood while supporting their mental health. I'd like to begin by sharing a quote from a mother that I interviewed. She described navigating mental health as a new parent as a nightmare. She shared it can be a lonely and terrifying experience, like walking through the forest in the dark. And often, there are so many lights around, but you don't know that they are just out of reach because continuity of care and systems collaboration is very low. This metaphor reflects the reality that many parents in the United States will experience. Up to 85% of perinatal individuals in the US experience some type of mood disturbance in the postpartum period, which is the 1 year after birth. This is often known as the baby blues, and it usually resolves itself within 2 weeks' time without treatment. However, up to 1 in 5 perinatal individuals will experience more severe symptoms of a perinatal mental health condition within that first year. In the United States, 4 million births occur yearly, meaning that up to 800,000 people will experience a perinatal mental health condition each year. Collectively, this group of conditions is known as PMADs, which stands for perinatal or postpartum mood and anxiety disorders. Compounding the problem, most perinatal individuals who experience a postpartum mood disorder go undiagnosed or do not receive adequate treatment, despite these disorders being highly treatable. Left untreated, perinatal mental health conditions can lead to serious long-term health complications for both the parent, the child, as well as impacting the well-being of the larger family unit. Social design has the potential to deepen the impact of existing interventions in the ecosystem and bring together stakeholders across these levels from the individual, interpersonal, organizational, community, and policy levels, and to create new innovations that support perinatal individuals and families. Based on my initial exploration, I formed the hypothesis that in order to address perinatal and mental health effectively, we need to develop pathways that engage perinatal individuals and their support systems through collaborative clinical and social tools. With this in mind, I set out to answer the following. How might we co-create tools with perinatal individuals and providers that engage perinatal individuals and their social connections and empower them to navigate the transition to parenthood while supporting their mental health? Guided by this question, I set out to learn as much as possible about perinatal mental health while looking for a partner to collaborate with on this work. In October 2022, I connected with Dr. Thomas Mackey and Anna Schaefer, health systems researchers at SUNY Downstate Health Sciences University School of Public Health. They've been conducting a community engagement research project called Charting the Course for Patient-Centered Research to Address Inequities in Perinatal Mental Health and Maternal Mortality. Through my partnership, I've had the opportunity to support their project, which I provide more detail on in my process book. Working with my partner on this engagement project has been an incredible opportunity to learn from experts in the field of perinatal mental health with diverse skill sets and experiences across the ecosystem, including the 3 universities listed there, as well as Postpartum Support International, which is a leading nonprofit. Additionally, I had the opportunity to work with parents who have lived expertise of a perinatal mental health condition. Through meetings with project leadership, advisory council sessions, and my own primary and secondary research, I began to see patterns in the gaps across the perinatal mental health experience. Based on some of the insights and opportunities that began to emerge, I developed a second work stream for my thesis work where I began brainstorming how social design could address some of these opportunities. Through a series of prototyping, feedback, and iteration activities, I worked through a series of concepts to present back to the community for further development and refinement, ultimately leading to my final thesis intervention. Once I developed these initial prototypes, I shared them with my community partner, and we discussed which one seemed most promising and feasible given the thesis timeline, partner capacity, and opportunities for impact. Ultimately, we felt that prototype number 3, the Love Mom postcard campaign, was the most interesting from a social perspective and the most feasible at scale. We moved into a series of co-design workshops that I led virtually over the course of a month with a group of Postpartum Support International staff and volunteers, all of whom are parents and many of whom are also survivors of a perinatal mental health condition. In our first workshop, we spent time introducing the project and prototyping the experience of writing a postcard, with parents responding to the prompt, "What is a message that you would want to share with someone who is navigating the transition to parenthood and trying to support their mental health?" Reflecting on the experience of writing one of these postcards, participants shared that receiving a postcard like this as a new parent would have been really helpful. Quote, "I think it would have been really great to get a postcard like this as a new parent and then have the ability to write back and forth with the same person more than once. I think it might be helpful. It's nice to get a heartwarming message, but it's even cooler to have a community built around it." Reflecting on the tone of the postcard, one parent said, "I didn't want to be all positive because it's not. It's hard. It's the hardest thing I've ever done. This led to a discussion about how we can create space for the range of emotions that a new parent might be experiencing in this transition and to normalize them through this initiative. The purpose of our second session was to think through key audiences for the postcard initiative. This quote reflects the challenge of designing an initiative to support new parents. No two experiences of parenthood or mental health are the same. With this in mind, we discussed different scenarios for the postcards and how they might work as individual concepts or as a series of offerings. We established that any solution would need to be flexible to accommodate a range of needs, and we tested out different ways to opt into these scenarios during our third session. And in our fourth and final workshop, we dove deeper into the language used in the initiative, discussed the visual identity of the project, and considered next steps for bringing all of the work together. After the workshops, I spent some time synthesizing all of the learnings from each of the workshops and came up with the following design principles that should guide the final intervention. It should foster connection through conversation. It should ensure that the format is approachable and digestible, especially given how busy parents are and how overwhelmed they might be. We should design for offline experiences where possible, allow for flexibility and modularity within the system, leverage existing systems such as the great work being done by PSI and refer to what is already working, use intentional and inclusive language, amplify parents' voices, and lastly, spread awareness and drive towards action. And with that, I'm excited to introduce to you my thesis intervention, which is Pep Talks. Pep Talk stands for Perinatal Engagement Pathways, Tools to Amplify Lived Knowledge Sharing, and it reimagines what it means to care for perinatal individuals' mental health in the transition to parenthood. Pep Talks is a community platform that offers tools and resources to improve access to perinatal mental health care by connecting individuals and families to the support that they need. The Pep Talks acronym is a nod to the supportive energy underpinning this project towards improving perinatal mental health support for individuals and families by uplifting the voices of those with lived expertise. The first service provided by Pep Talks is Pep Talks Post, a series of postcard engagements designed to leverage the power of writing, connection, and collective storytelling to increase discussion around perinatal mental health and provide parents with clear pathways to connect with additional support. There are several ways to engage with Pep Talks Post. First offering is an anonymous forum for sharing postcards that serves as a place for that collective storytelling about perinatal mental health, allowing parents to read other stories and to submit their own experience of navigating mental health if they choose. The second offering, Pep Talk Pen Pals, is a physical postcard exchange between a parent with lived expertise of a perinatal mental health condition and a new parent over an agreed upon period of time, designed to foster a connection between parents who have that experience and new parents who are going through the transition. And the third offering is a postcard kit for personal reflection and interpersonal connection. Parents receive a kit with prompts for personal reflection as a way to facilitate discussion about their mental health with their social connection, including family, friends, and their care providers. The beauty of this system is that it allows parents to engage how they want to, with one element alone or as a series of supportive offerings. As I move forward, I'll be looking for opportunities to conduct a pilot of the anonymous postcards and the Pep Talks pen pal exchange with a local postpartum support group, such as one of the Postpartum Support International local chapters. I'll also consider how we continue to build out features on the platform that facilitate connection between perinatal individuals and their social support networks. Lastly, my hope for this work is to contribute to the long overdue national dialogue about perinatal mental health. What if instead of the transition to parenthood being a nightmare, we collectively dreamt of a future in which we as a society hold new parents with as much care as they hold their own children? Thank you. And next up, we have Daphne and Nancy.
Hello, welcome. Today we will start from the past and move forward to explore the rich traditional culture. I want to kick off with a story. In the southwestern of China, there is a minority group named Miao. For thousands of years, Miao people have been working and living in the mountains there. However, the Miao people don't have their written language, so they use embroidery to record their history and culture, which named Miao embroidery. The Miao embroidery expressed the Miao people's understanding of the everything in the universe, which includes the mythical animals, cloud, butterfly, dragon, and stuff. So it looks very beautiful, but it's also very fragile. The heritage of the Miao embroidery is passed down from the older generation to the younger generation through the oral tradition. And I want to share this photo from 1970, which is very precious because it is very hard for us to see such thing at nowadays. And less young people learning and engaging in the Miao embroidery ecosystem.
In the reports from the 2019, 75% of the Miao craft women are over 45 years old. The average age of them is over 15 years old. The Miao embroidery is on the verge of the getting lost with the time. The whole system is a gradually aging and facing a serious heritage crisis. Why did this happen? I want to share the data with you. The average salary of the Miao craft woman is only $500 per month, which is half the average salary in their province. With the deepening gap between economic and social development, over the past 15 years, more and more Miao young people have moved from the mountain to the city to study and work. The older generation of Miao craft women choose to stay in the mountain. The young people living in the big city are getting the test of the modern education, tech, and arts. This has really changed their sense of the beauty and their values. So they are not getting much of the chance to learn about or understand the Miao embroidery. There was the one Miao young people study fashion design and express the lack of the reverence of the Miao embroidery, and she think it was old-fashioned, monotonous, and rustic. Our problem statement is the traditional Miao embroidery is facing a heritage crisis due to the lack of a modern relevance, limited transmission, and a low economic incentive. How might we encourage young Miao inheritors to actively engage with the Miao embroidery and utilize innovative means to maintain the place of the tradition practiced in modern culture? I'm Luo Xianru and come from the Tuja ethnic minority group, which has lived with the Miao people generation after generation. So since my undergraduate, I have been exploring how to use the digital media arc to keep the Miao culture alive for the next generation.
I'm Wang Wanqiu, as a person from China's main nationality, representing 91% of China's population, I have limited exposure to the ethnic minority culture before. At DSI, I saw Daphne's efforts to preserving the heritage of the minority culture, which deeply touched my heart, so we decided to work together. And now I'm excited to share that we partner with Deng Li, the curator of China's largest Miao embroidery museum. She and her father have been working, collecting, and innovating with the Miao embroidery for over 70 years. We work closely with her for the entire thesis process and bridging the gap between the China and the United States. And I'm also very happy to share that she has even enjoyed joining us today as an audience. We can find her in the audience.
We are just to talk about the friction between minority culture tradition and the modern life before. By bringing these two things together, as the social designers, we see an opportunity to sustainably preserve the Miao embroidery tradition. The opportunity is leveraging the modern technology for dissemination, encouraging community involvement, helping young Miao people to connect with their culture. Our main focus is to serve and empower the Miao people, making sure they are always at the center of our actions.
For modern technology, we combine Web3 technology to release NFT. I know maybe some of you are unfamiliar with NFT. NFT are non-fungible tokens. Most importantly, NFT serve as a platform for permanently preserving cultural heritage, giving us the opportunity to ensure the cultural endurance for generations to come.
With this platform, we choose to upload 100 Miao embroidery image NFT to help more people become more familiar with and understand the story and the culture of the Miao embroidery. There are many different patterns in the Miao embroidery that represents over 100 different tribes from Miao. In particular, we choose one pattern named crosses at this time, which represent unity, harmony, and the connection between the human and nature. We uploaded 100 cross-stick patterns on the NFT trading platform OpenSea, and the response was amazing. People love the pattern, and it really helped to get more people interested and invest in the Miao embroidery.
We continue our journey to explore how to deepen our understanding of this culture and enhance community engagement. We collaborate with the Guizhou radio TV station in China to produce a documentary. In this documentary, we share our experience as the international youth working to develop and innovate the Miao embroidery heritage. We also connect with other young people who have the same dream of passing on Miao minority culture, helping us to reach a wider audience to embrace the culture.
In our next step, we want to build a connection between the Miao embroidery and the public. So we joined the art fair hosted by the Mo Hui Sun and Ivy Tan from DSI. We want to create a platform where people can learn about, engage with, and celebrate with the beautiful and intricate art form. It was a great time people in the New York City could get close to the Miao embroidery collection. And we're also very happy to meet many people who are interested in the Miao embroidery and have gained 7 opportunities to work together in the future. And in addition, we have generated over $2,000 in revenue in 2 days. We plan to give back it to the community. We want to build a bridge linking the cultural heritage of the mountain to the modern market. So maybe it's us now stand in this scene. It's also the conversation between the Miao culture from the mountain and the young people in the New York City.
Good news to share. Our city partner has a registered company in New York, and we will continue our mission as the co-founders to carry out the legacy of the past forward. We will do exploration in the future, always keeping Miao people in the circle. You know, a single thread cannot make a pretty pattern by itself. It takes a bunch of more threads to come together. We are hoping you will be one of the threads, joining us to weave an amazing and beautiful pattern. If you want to talk or share some opportunity with us, please follow us over Instagram at the pathforward.culture. Big thanks to you all. The project couldn't have happened without the Miao community, our city partners, our team, and all of you here today. Please allow me to say thank you in Miao language. Ji Ko, thank you.
Okay. Hi there. My name is Shashank, and this is my project. I'm Shashank Sharma, but I also go by the name Sinyasi, and I've been making comics and stories on my Instagram channel for some time now. You can check it out later. But I'm also an engineer, a teacher, a nonviolent communication practitioner, and now a social designer, among other things. But primarily, I think like to think of myself as a storyteller, so I'm gonna try and tell you a story today. So this particular story started about 10 years ago when I joined Teach for India right out of engineering college as a fellow. And this was me teaching in a low-income government classroom in New Delhi for 2 years. And these were the kids I had, 42, 8-year-olds. And I have some of the best memories from that particular time, but also some tough ones. And so it was quite obvious for me to start looking for a thesis project in which was related to education and equity. And we all suffered from the pandemic, but not all of us have suffered equally. And so right now, there's a dire situation with regards to educational outcomes, especially among the underprivileged and low social economic communities. So the journey hasn't been simple. I asked myself a bunch of these questions, you know, while trying to get to, you know, what is the problem that I'm trying to solve? And something that we're taught here at DSI is that, you know, before we design something, we should ask who's missing from the table. And this is kind of what I came back to. And the answer was representation. But I got to that when I began working with my thesis partner, Care2Play. Care2Play is a conglomerate of 5 organizations, Indus Action, Saja, Trickle Up, ID Insight, and Rocket Learning. And their goal was to address the issues of early childhood access to nutrition and education in the New Delhi region. And my goal was to get closer to development sector organizations in India and understand the issues of equity that they're dealing with. So I signed on as a designer and facilitator. And while conducting the workshop, you know, I looked around and I said, you know, who's missing from the table? And the community was. And when it's India and, you know, we're looking for who's missing from the table, the issue that sort of really stands out is the issue of caste. So I began researching about caste, and caste in India is thousands of years old, and the lessons and from it are passed from generation to generation. And caste is essentially a hierarchy of power, like who gets to wield power and who does not. And so let's look at how caste manifests in India. So the current reality is that the Hindu high caste is about 21% of India's population, while the rest is 79%. But the reality is that the Hindu high caste has 41% of India's wealth as compared to the rest. In media, the Hindu high caste represents 88% of all media personnel. But in the prison system in India, the Hindu high caste represents only 7.9% of India's prisoners. So, you know, this makes you ask, like, where's the justice among all this? And by the way, I belong to the Hindu high caste. So where's the justice in all this? But the other thing is, like, is the Hindu high caste just better than everyone else? And Jared Diamond, in his book Guns, Germs, and Steel, you know, suggests otherwise. So he suggests that, you know, societies develop over time because of environmental factors, because of random factors, because of social factors, and that advantage is then passed on from generation to generation. And so this particular belief, you know, I thought should be there in the development sector already. And in order to verify, I spoke to 2 ex-colleagues from Teach for India who are now leaders in the education sector. And I asked them if that was the case. And turns out that the development sector, or the NGO sector in India, is essentially pro-bias. The best pitches are the ones with the, you know, best markers of privilege, like, you know, an Ivy League education or equivalent. And so here's what I decided to work on. How might we develop a project that aids intervention designers, leaders in the development sector, and teachers see how privilege develops in systems over time? Counter the narratives of privilege already present in the system and facilitate conversations regarding addressing these inequities. And so this is where my project came to be, Perspective, a game of social inequities. But why a game? So games have the potential to engage learners in ways that traditional classroom instruction often fails to do. But also, I've been a gamer all my life. Games like Age of Empires, Sid Meier's Civilization, Dwarf Fortress, RimWorld, Catan have taught me a lot about systems and strategy. And at the same time, during my workshop with Care to Play, I helped them develop this particular system that you can see on the bottom right. This is the ecosystem in which they operate. But there's another reason. So the World Bank in October 2022 adopted the Multidimensional Poverty Index, which moves away from just looking at poverty in monetary terms, and now also has health, education, and standard of living in order to understand what poverty really looks like. And so how do you simulate this system? And so I went through, you know, just a few simple iterations, you know, just a couple. And then I decided that these were my goals for designing the game, to keep it really simple, to simulate the systems logically, to make it playable offline and online, because a lot of the community I was working with was in India. And, you know, facilitation should be safe and constructive. And so this was my final outcome. And this particular game is all about domination, at least initially. So the players begin on an unclaimed game board and gather resources. They slowly capture tiles as they go along using the resources they acquired. And eventually the player who's able to capture the most amount of resources and tiles comes to dominate the board. And then the next stage is consolidate. So it's all about discussing what happened during the game. Questions are raised about what happened, what are the power dynamics in the game, the trajectory of each community as the game progressed, and a lot of such discussions. But the final part is cooperation. How do we get to equity in a system that is so unbalanced? How do we share power? And also, what even is fair in a system like this? So in order to see if the game was actually working, I had over 20 test sessions with multiple playtesters, and we asked questions like, who has the most power on this board? Which community now represents the dominant culture? What do you think the repercussions will be of that? And who has the least power on the board? What do you think will happen to that particular community? And I also ended up training ChatGPT with the rules of the game and running multiple simulations in order to verify if the game was working properly. But also the ironic thing here is that ChatGPT itself has been trained on data sets of privilege. So that was a little bit funny. So the feedback that I received was in line with what I was hoping for. Players had a better understanding of privilege, but also at the same time, they were frustrated because there were things that they just couldn't do that they would expect to do from a strategy game. And so I feel that really honed in what the idea of privilege is. And again, the more you have, the more you will have, because you can develop resources in order to get there. And so I'm going to conclude with the story, the next Ramanujan. So Ramanujan is one of the greatest mathematicians of all time. And in fact, he's one of the greatest Indian mathematicians, you know, of all time. And I'm going to move to this fact. Statistically, almost 2 Indians for every 7 people in the world, right? But we are not represented in literature or research. So if there is a Ramanujan waiting somewhere in India, they probably won't have the right opportunity to bloom. So my hope is that through interventions that are better designed, inclusive, and driven by an awareness of privilege and power, we can provide a better future for the children out there. We need to unlearn a few things. How do we get the people who aren't at the table on it? It's not possible to do that by the rules of the current system. We need to redefine what is fair. And so I'm going to end with a quote from the author of Nonviolent Communication. Don't just do something, stand there. Thank you. I'd like to thank my family who've been, you know, very supportive through this very erratic journey. My chair, Mia, Kara, you know, who's helped me a lot through this project, the thesis advisor group, my friends back home who are probably watching this, you know, my partners, and of course, you know, DSI, thank you so much for you know, all the heavy discussions I got us into. Thank you so much. And you know, next up, it's let us eat together. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. And I'm gonna start with a quote. The world-renowned chef and entrepreneur Jose Andrews once says, reducing food waste is something that each of us can do, and it can start with the small changes in our home and communities. And my name is Ziyuan.
And hi, everyone. My name is Kexin.
And growing up for me, my family always taught me to cherish food since I was a little. But when I moved to New York, I found I was wasting a lot of food every day, and which make me feel guilty.
And my story is very similar with Ziyuan. Now, when I came to New York and I saw the food waste problem, we started to wonder how to prevent this issue, and is there anything we could do about that?
And according to the report by the World Food Program, near a third of all food product each year is wasted before it can be consumed. And this amount is about 1.3 million billion pounds per year, worth approximately $1 trillion US. And this is a staggering amount. In New York City especially, people are also contributing to this issue of food waste, especially young people. So according to a study conducted by Natural Resource Defense councils, young people in New York City tend to waste more food than another age groups. The study found that 18 to 34 years old in New York City waste approximately 20% of the food they purchased, compared to the 13 of those 35 years and older. So in order for us to better understand food waste challenges among young people in New York City, we conduct detect service, conduct interviews, and held a workshop with about 17 young people in age between 18 to 34 who live in New York City to figure out their challenge and understand that what kind of idea they might to have to tackle this issue. And based on our research, and we learned that young people have tendency to purchase more food than they actually need. As a result of busy lifestyle and lack of knowledge on how to cook certain food, a significant amount of purchased food end up spoiling in the fridge. Although young people are aware of the effect of the food waste, they struggle to take actions. And building on the inside and formal research, we also identify some of the key challenges of young people to reduce food waste, which are young people lack of food preservation skills and cooking skills. They have difficulty finding more accessible resources and solutions that help them to take on this positive change. And young people are really think more ways to feel motivated to reduce food waste. And in addition to all this, our research help us gathering ideas and learn more about what can we motivate young people to integrate food waste. Participants also suggest that more education and information about food preservation and cooking, and develop more engaging activities and interactions that can engage young people to better participate in food waste reduction activities. And to gain a deeper understanding of the problem of food waste, we invited Christina Chen as a consultant and partners. She is passionate about food waste, and as she is the founder of a nonprofit organization in New York called Foodie Pass, an online community that allows people to sell and purchase home-cooked meals for pickup and bring people together through food and let more people to have affordable and healthy meals. And then we summarize some of the core problem of food waste among young people. That is, how might we narrow the gap between young people's knowledge and action to improve access and increase motivation to take action to reduce food waste? And to help us to refine these questions, we engage in a series of prototype. And now I'm gonna let Kashin to introduce more about our prototype.
Thank you. And so for our first prototype, we launched an event through the Foodie Pass called Earth Bistro, where we cook delicious dishes from surplus ingredients to share with the Foodie Pass members. Yeah. And the results show us young people are interested in sharing the surplus food, but there are limited resources to share. Also, young people are concerned about the food safety when the food from other strangers. And so we found that building multi-trust is an important factor. So we conduct the second prototype based on the funding. We thought, what if we got trust network together to tackle this problem? So we decided to have a dinner with a close friend to see what this might look like and to address this concern. So at this dinner, people decided what they want to eat based on the ingredients they brought, and we prepare, cook, and eat together. So in the process, we learned that preparing food together is a trust environment can really minimize people's concern. And by gathering the people to eat together, we can foster more opening discussion about food waste. However, we found that because we are close friends and we easily drop into the discussion unrelated to the food waste problem. So if we want to keep people focused on the issue of food waste, we need to introduce activity that make people engage. And so based on what we learned from all this prototype, we began to refine our focus and ask ourselves, how might we use the nature of food sharing to raise awareness about reducing food waste and hopefully ultimately change people's behavior? So based on the research and prototype, we design our final intervention, Let Us Eat Together. It is a platform that enables young people to come together to address food waste through communal activity and dinners. And Let Us Eat Together incorporates suggestion dinner flow, activity cards, discussion promotes, and storytelling. And we hope to expand this platform and create modular system where people can host dinner, breakfast, or lunch themselves by a small or large group. So those are something we are thinking about right now. And we write a dinner event flow introduction on the platform, facilitate people to understand how to host by themselves. So first, the organizer invite their friends to get together. And they ask everyone come to bring any supplies, food, or ingredients they have at home of any kind. So as everyone come together, a sense of community builds. The organizer extend a warm welcome to all, followed by the brief outline the gathering objective. And then the group cooking adventure begins. So everyone helped to clean the food they brought, moving any spoiled items, then decided together what the meal they cook based on the food left. And we also have designed some food theme card game. Picture here is called Rescue Food. Player draw the three cards, food cards, event cards, and action cards. So the players can use these cards to make a story about stopping food waste. So post-meal, these games are not just entertainment, but also the conversation starter. The creator create a lively atmosphere as a service of fine nature platform for the discussion of food waste, as well as exchange the tip of food preservation and cooking. So Foodie Pass enjoyable working with us, as a result, they were promoting let us eat together on their platform. So we will continue to looking for other partners who can support our work or help us building partnership together. So we can point young people to all these great resources that are being developed by us and like other people's Christina. And when I come back, I want to share the important idea of not wasting food. And we make a place where people feel to share their idea, especially with young people in New York. This is for all of us, and we will keep working on it together. So let us eat together. And also, I would like to say thank you to all the people who have helped us here. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon, and thank you for staying with us for so long. I'm very excited to present my thesis work with all of you. So this is a typical view you'd get from your apartment when you're living in Mumbai. It's very similar to New York City with all its tall buildings that cover the sky, the fast-paced life, and the densely packed streets. Luckily, I was on the other side. I woke up to this every day, watching the sun set into the water body that harbors mangroves, integral to the ecosystem that is home to so many seasonal animals, made me realize the importance of nature and all her components. Similarly, during my undergrad internship, I chose to immerse myself in a completely different ecosystem, the mountains. I visited a nondescript village nestled amidst the craggy peaks of Kargil. Hunderman settlement is an unusual architecture coexisting with the mountains, mountain ranges instead of working against the force of nature, which reminded me that we needed to view nature not as a resource to be extracted, but as a collaborator to work with. Recent capitalistic practices have evolved to become slowly about profits, not realizing the harm they might cause around it. For example, the leather industry, which was traditionally in traditional art, has now become an industry which is estimated to be about $408 billion. The industry runoff from the leather tanneries affect the waterways that are near them and end up harming the humans inhabiting it. Tannery workers often suffer major chemical burns while handling harsh carcinogenic chemicals in the factory. But what really interested me is the socioeconomic precursors that led to these anthropocentric environmental harms. Real life practices around structures that promote and maintain these social and environmental disparities. Cis, hetero, white supremacy, colonialism, and modern capitalism are long-term ecological processes that disproportionately harm black and brown bodies and the planet. Western Earth and environmental science does not, and as it functions, cannot address these problems. The Critical Ecology Lab aims to deepen our understanding of how these processes shape the society and the planet by giving voice to questions and actions and grounded in a more expansive understanding of global change. So what are these social drivers of environmental change? Some of these are, they're often extractive in nature. That means they value self-gain and more than collective good. They have a myopic view of making decisions without considering long-term impacts. They are a scarcity-based mindset and view resources as limited and scarce. They're wasteful and individualistic, which prioritize individual rights and freedoms over collective goods and downplay the social and economical impacts of individual actions. Going back to critical ecology, Being a microbial ecologist and biogeochemist, Dr. Priya drives a lot of her inspiration from microbes. Another ecology I saw myself being driven towards. Western society took off and ran with the tidy notion that social interactions mirror the perceived ruthlessness of the natural world. But biology is more nuanced than this and is filled with examples of organisms of the same and different species operating cooperatively and patiently. An example of this being SCOBY, a bacterial alternative to the leather industry. SCOBY exists in our daily lives as kombucha, a probiotic beverage that is readily available at most of our corner stores and is a great substrate for SCOBY to grow in. So the liquid here is kombucha, and the gloopy mass on top is SCOBY. Usually seen as waste, my place of work, Slow Factory, a climate justice organization, harnessed the potential of this bacterial world to make 100% biodegradable leather. I would spend my days sometimes having more bacterial interactions than human, making sure the environment was perfect for them to thrive. We'd name them mostly to keep track, but I soon found myself becoming more attuned to the bacterial needs, much like people who start to notice, begin and observe and spend time with this culture. This is a video of me burping my favorite SCOBY, Piper. She was a star SCOBY, and this act of caring beyond myself engendered values that you see common in people who engage in such acts like the kombucha community. Values that show up are also directly related to the processes of growth and properties of SCOBY. It's infinitely regenerative, so a lot of urge to share appears to be a common behavioral pattern resulting from SCOBY being treated as a superfluous commodity. Since the process is slow and takes methodical steps to keep the culture living, people often have found a newfound appreciation for slower processes. This is a multi-species symbiotic event. People also emphasizes the importance of collaboration. Feelings of being interconnected to the bacterial world arose, and you have to be attentive to the well-being of this living culture. These bacterial values stood starkly against the existing processes of making the same product, which made me question, how might we realize the potential of bacterial world to harness them and move away from existing extractive practices? Through my secondary research, I conducted semi-structured interviews and focus groups with material scientists that worked with kombucha in different forms and home brewers that have been brewing kombucha from anywhere between a few weeks to a couple of months. I realized that even though kombucha has become common, people don't recognize the potential of the bacterial culture around it. Since there is minimal chance of engagement with the bacterial culture so as to recognize and notice them in order to realize their potential. I also realized that there was another insight that information around and innovation around this material looks much like this. These screenshots over here, which end up stifling innovation near this region. Initially, I was speaking to kombucha consumers to reintroduce the beverage as a means of engaging with the bacterial world through a brew book, but soon learned that learning how to take care of the bacterial culture for the first time on your own is an information overload and people needed to be guided through workshopping with them. Which brings me to my second prototype, which was an entirely online workshop among home brewers that gives them a better understanding of SCOBY and provide them with space to engage in resources about different uses with SCOBY. I did not want them to give a final product, but instead give a better understanding of the material so that they can bring in their lived experiences to explore different uses of this culture. Both of these led to my final intervention, an approach for practitioners to teach biomaterials to introduce behavioral change called the culture of culture. I sought to bacterialize human culture by introducing the properties of SCOBY in the process of caring for SCOBY by creating a fun character that embodied them. This helped the participants to actually be friends with the bacteria and fostered a feeling of kinship while also dismantling negative connotations associated with bacteria. The second part aimed to provide inspiration and technique about biomaterial solutions. I demonstrated a dyeing process that gave space for participants to interact with the material in this process by providing participants with prompts and discussions to encourage them to glean from the bacterial world and realize how they can implement these practices and values in their lives, giving rise to feeling of being interconnected and collaboration. The last part involved providing participants with a booklet that served them as space for reflection on their journey with growing and interacting with SCOBY, while also providing them a good culture to take back with them. As feedback, I got somebody mentioned there is much more magic waiting for us to explore outside human society. Bring me to away from the human centralized mindset for a while. As Robin Wall Kimmerer said, other small beings issue an invitation to dwell for a time right at the limits of ordinary perception. All it requires for us is attentiveness. Look in a certain way, and a whole new world will be revealed. This work wouldn't have been possible without all these wonderful beings, both humans and non-humans. I am so grateful for all of you being here. Thank you for sticking with me. Thank you, Mia. Thank you, Sahar. Thank you, Mari, and all my lovely cohort members. Thank you for people watching. And this is starting to sound like an Oscar acceptance speech. But I hope to continue building world with ecosystems that can coexist. So thank you.
Thank you for being here so long. I'm the last one, so we are almost there. Hi, I'm Uyo. Use she, her pronouns. I'm an animal lover and a social designer. So who else are also animal lovers here? Awesome. Today let's talk about our faithful friends, birds. Birds are one of our most frequent neighbors. As you know, a lot of birds migrate. By the way, this Saturday will be World Migratory Bird Day. Every spring and fall, millions of birds migrate through the New York City along the Atlantic Flyway. And plus local birds, more than 200 different species frequent the city each year. Birds also mean a lot to us. They help pollinate flowers and food crops, disperse seeds and control pests for a healthy ecosystem. Also, birds can have a positive impact on our mental well-being because they offer a natural connection, stress relief, and inspiration on arts with songs and colorful aesthetics. And bird watching industry generates billions of dollars in economic impact. However, the encounter is a deadly one. Each year, between 90,000 and 230,000 birds are killed here in collisions with building glass. What's more frustrating, after the collision, birds may flee, hide, and die in other places, or other wild predators might grab the fallen body before we discover it. Therefore, many people don't know this issue exists. What will happen if we lost birds? Imagine a world where no more sweet sounds from the trees and sky, and the ecosystem would be thrown into domino disarray. There would be a decline in the vegetation and fauna in the concrete jungle, causing a rise in pests and disrupting the delicate balance of the environment. The city would feel less alive, less vibrant, less human and other creatures. So I want to ask, how might we make New York City become more bird-friendly to improve the quality of urban livability for people and birds with better coexistence? The very first step is to reconnect myself to nature. I made a bird feeder and placed it in a park. While there, I had the pleasure of observing adorable birds around, hearing interesting bird stories from park goers, and even a park staff helped me position the feeder. This was a truly wonderful and natural experience. I was honored to join Project Safe Flight by New York City Audubon, which is an organization that works for the protection of wild birds and habitats. We walked migration routes in the city to find, help, and record dead and injured birds from collisions. I also got to know that there are already some existing solutions addressing bird collision issues. Bird-friendly designs are gradually utilized in constructions, and legislation has been passed mandating their use in New York City. However, the number of collision records has still been increasing. Moreover, according to my survey conducted in several parks, only 2 out of 20 people were aware of bird collisions. Well, we really need more awareness and interventions to tackle this issue. I hope to seek opportunities from our relationship with nature. There are 3 keywords: biophilia, which is the innate human instinct to connect with nature and other living beings. Secondly, ethos, since we are part of this system, and if the system thrives, then we thrive. If the system is challenged, we are going to be challenged. The last one is standing in nature inspires a sense of awe, and such a feeling is a psychological phenomenon that we have to nurture and live in a relationship with. However, facing some species, aka pigeons, we may just feel ill instead of awe. We do not know they actually have many admirable qualities we should value, such as resilience in harsh environments, lifelong loyalty to their mates, and historical roles in message and food delivery during wartime. So how can I increase people's appreciation for urban nature? How to promote engagement in conservation efforts for birds? I'm gonna use a quote to respond. Lack of action is not caused by lack of knowledge. To act differently, people need to see differently. So let's see differently. As humans, we were predators back then, just like wolves, lions, and bears. We have eyes in the front of our heads and good depth perception, whereas most birds' eyes are placed at the side of their heads, just like other prey animals like rabbits, deer, and squirrels. Birds judge the flight speed by the passing of object to their sides, so their focus in flight is not necessarily ahead. To a bird, the reflections on glass look like the sky or habitat, something they should be able to fly right through. This is how collisions happen. I wish to let individuals develop an understanding of bird experiences and emotions, so let me introduce my bird helmets. They are designed to let people experience a bird's vision. Wearing these, participants can only see through the side eye holes. With the bird helmet on, the vision to the front is unclear and hard to focus because it simulates the blind gap of a bird's perspective. The participants had to be very cautious to avoid crashing into anything. They needed to keep shaking their heads to use their peripheral vision to confirm what was in front of them. They kind of feel how tough city life the birds are experiencing. I also held several human plus bird roleplay meetings to explore what's good for birds with my community partners, including people from my previous activities and my neighborhood. During the meeting, some participants role-played as birds, and the others were humans to do the discussions. We also penned a proposal letter to our residential buildings, advocating them to adopt bird-friendly glass. A meaningful feedback for this role-play meeting is a person who played bird first, even though she switched to human after, could not help continuing to consider birds' benefits. We can see role-playing is a really good way to develop empathy from another perspective, to think differently. The participants also helped co-design a digital framework that can allow people to DIY the patterns of anti-collision stickers for their windows. These stickers can help birds to recognize that this window is not a place they can fly through. My slogan is to make our window bird friendly by making our window bird unwelcome. The framework will automatically arrange patterns according to the 2x2-inch rule, which is a spacing standard that has been proven effective in preventing bird collisions. Since it's AAPI Heritage Month now, I collaborated with the amazing Thesis team, Pass Forward. We designed a set of window stickers featuring Miao embroidery patterns as they just introduced. It is a China's ethnic cultural heritage. The stickers showcase the charm of Miao embroidery while protecting birds. On Earth Day this year, I doodled the concept of bird-friendly design on glass windows and doors in the art and design affair held by our another awesome thesis project. It attracted passersby to join me in painting the glass together. I'm really proud I have motivated more people to engage and get to know the idea of being bird-friendly. To further develop my project, I want to serve it as an educational module for younger generations by providing a fun toolkit for schools. It will allow students to make feeders, bird helmets, and window stickers by themselves to get involved in creating bird-friendly urban environment. Overall, I hope for a better world where people, birds, and all other creatures can hum with each other and where nature can thrive. Chirp, my special thanks to my DSI community, thesis partners, my beloved, and the great nature, and thank you all for listening and joining our journey.
Thank you so much. We started today with a breath from the thesis advisor. So I'm going to ask you to take another deep breath, knowing that we have these amazing creative thinkers and designers going out into the world. I think we're in good hands. It gives me some hope. You'll be leading the way. I want to thank all of you for participating, for cheering them on, for being there. I know families and friends, this journey is weird and wonderful and at times stressful. And I know the students were just absolutely counting on their supporters. And so all of you online as well. So thank you so much for being a part of this journey as well. This work is world building, as you saw. It's collaborative. It takes each one of us to participate. So I would really like to thank Alain Sylvain for being our keynote tonight, the amazing class of 2023, and our DSI faculty, some of you who are here, and all of our community, past and present. We do have some alumni also here. Thank you to the Thesis Core advisors. You are the heart. You are up late nights, reading slides, hearing this over and over again. And so thank you. We couldn't really do this work ever without all of you. Mari, Kara, Sahar, Lona, Allison, and Despina, who teach Thesis One. President David Rhodes and the SVA community is right there with us. And this show could not be possible without my DSI team, Gail Linares, Dimitri Martin, Carolyn Cicerotti. You've made all of the decisions, big and small, to get us here today. So thank you. And the SVA Theater for making all of this run. There's no way I would have been able to do this. The class of 2024 is upcoming next. And Joy and Brielle were here helping out. So thank you for being there for your community. Lenine Wells, Sublation Studio, did this beautiful branding today. And thank you for always supporting our thesis show. And to all of our communities, our partners who came, volunteered their times, these students aren't given their partners. They have to go and seek them out. And that's part of the leadership that they show and the collaboration they show as they find these groups in New York, in China, in India, from coast to coast, sometimes even bacterial animals and birds become our partners. So thank you. This year is really special for us. DSI turns 10. So I want to acknowledge Cheryl Heller, who was our founding chair of this program, for her vision and belief that this work could be taught, it could be shared, it could be learned. And we've grown it over the years. Design, I'm just struck with the fact that we will have to show up differently to reflect the extreme changes in our natural and social systems that are emerging in unexpected ways. So we have to encourage each other to think critically and collectively, to coexist and also dream. Class of 2023, I hope you'll bear with me, but I always have to say a few words to you all. I'm so proud of you. You have taken risks to venture, to see what the world is going to look like in the future. It is going to look different. You questioned and considered these critical social issues of our time and what we need to care about for all of our futures. You've shown vulnerability, bravery. We've cried together. I cried today. Especially in your positionality and your honesty to center communities. I've been learning with each one of you how to do that in a slightly different way, and I hope that people who are here today also take that as a new step forward. Your work took you to the universe. It took you to the metaverse. It took you to the microverse. So our worlds are expanding. So please continue to do this work. You remind me that we need more creativity and grace, diversity, equity, and justice. We have to break these stigmas. We have to stop the violence. We need more love. So Fabulous 15, Pallavi. Let's see if I'm doing this. You're all out of order. Pallavi, Brittany, Mohui, Krutika, Effie, Ikun, Riddhi, Sophia, Nancy, Daphne, Shashank, Jesse, Diva, Wuyo. I will miss you so dearly to the bottom of my soul. But now it's time for you to go and go out into this world and continue and deepen what you've started. You've already been connecting the dots amongst each other. You built off of each other's projects. You're growing something incredible from deep below the soil out into the skies. So please go on and keep going. I wanted to say that remind you of this quote that from activist Yuri Kochiyama that says, life is not what you alone make it. Life is the input of everyone who has touched your life and every experience that entered it. You've grown so much since last September, and I'm excited to see where you go. So congratulations to the class of 2023. If you all just stand up just for a minute, you're all welcome. We have one more tradition, one more rituals. We love rituals at DSI, and it is that the class of 2024 supports the class that comes before it. So they have made you a video. So we're gonna watch that, and then we'll wrap up.
That time of the year, you've come so far. What a gift it is to learn beside you. Make waves, expand, and grow wherever you go. May you keep blooming and becoming.
Spring into the next chapter of life with your innate positivity and the skills to turn passion into lasting impact. Take encouragement from Rainer Maria Rilke to live in the questions.
Daisies are white, skies are blue. Your dedication and grace radiate through. Attentive, friendly, and kind as always, with an earnest and pure heart, may your dreams come true.
Tides turned, roads shifted, yet you anchored on. To your values, your vision, you wrestled over what you held close, what you learned to let go. Your heart poured into healthcare and your baked goods. Roses are red, violets are blue. Your charm and cheerfulness shine, you rule. The support we share, creating a bond that is called care.
You bring so much light and warmth to our space. Your ideas inspire, like the dancer you are. May you continue to move with care and grace and excel with brightness as you find your place.
With a warm and inviting smile, you greet all who come your way. Your dedication shines through in all that you do each day. To my friend who loves all things microbial, your love for these tiny creatures is infectious. May your passion continue to grow and thrive, and always see the world through a microbial lens alive.
Dear Liddy, you speak your mind with conviction and grace. Your courage and strength are an inspiration to embrace. We've talked about coffee and the chance to share our stories. May our paths cross soon as we share our passions, highs and lows.
In the journey of progress, it's the process that leads, as ideas are born from research and curious needs. With your persistence on finding what makes sense, wisdom shall guide as you move forward with no pretense. Dear Jesse, may uncertainty disappear, and all the fun and happiness be near. May you conquer fears and find your way clear. Wishing you a joyful journey, my dear.
In your mind, a dream once bright. Difficulties came and dimmed the light. But with knowledge and empathy aligned, overcoming all, the light shines refined.
Mahoy, oh what a joy you've been to all of us. We've loved your sweet and infectious energy, and your delicious potluck stew will stay in our memories. We wish you all the luck on your next journey in life. Your love for nature and creatures of the sky sparks joy and wonder for all. Bring that love to the places you'll go, you'll make a change, both big and small. Cushing, a waste warrior, stylish, skilled, and wise, cooking with intention, saving our planet's supplies.
With a love for knits, her typeface knowledge never quits. Running through the thrift stores, if it's handmade, it fits. Brooklyn attuned, her drawings make room. With a love for ABBA, the dancing queen's got moves. And after DSI, she'll be dedicated, motivated, and ready to zoom.
So it's my honor. Thank everyone. Please join me in congratulating DSI's class of 2023. Woo! We have at least 10 more years for this department, so keep going, come back. Thank you all for joining. I look forward to meeting you. And thank you. Have a great day. Enjoy this summer.